So lovely are your ways. You leading me. You lead me in. You leading me. You lead me in. My wellspring of life, my fountain from the Father, my elder brother, my Redeemer, Christ the Lord. So lovely are your ways, you leading me, you lead me. I worship you, Lord. I worship. I yield myself to you, O God, you are my design. How lovely are your ways, you leading me. How lovely are your ways, you lead me in. My wellspring, my fountain of life, my God, my Christ, my Redeemer, ransom's price. How lovely are the ways you lead me. How lovely are your ways you lead me in. My wellspring, my fountain of life, my Redeemer, Lord Jesus, my Christ. How lovely are your ways you lead me in. How lovely are your ways you lead me. My wellspring, my fountain of life, my Redeemer, Lord Jesus, you are my Christ. Ransom's price, Lord Jesus Christ. Come to me, says the Lord, and I will answer. Call to me, says the Lord, I will cause you to see. Call to me, and I will answer. Call unto me, and I will show you things. How lovely are your ways you leading me. How lovely are your ways you lead me. Oh, my wellspring, my fountain of life. Oh, my Redeemer. price. Lord Jesus, you are my Christ. How lovely are your ways, you lead me. How lovely are your ways, you lead me. My wellspring, my fountain of life. Say it. My wellspring, my fountain of life. Say it again. My wellspring, my fountain of life. My Redeemer, my Redeemer. Ransom's price, ransom's price. My wellspring, my fountain, oh life. My Redeemer, oh my Redeemer, oh ransom's price. My Lord Jesus, you are my Christ, you are my Christ. How lovely are, how lovely. Your ways, you leading me. How lovely are your ways, you lead me in. How lovely are your ways, you lead me in. My wellspring, my fountain of life. My Redeemer, your ransom's price. Lord Jesus, you are my Christ. How lovely are your ways, you leading me. Woo! How lovely are your ways, you lead me in. Your ways, you lead me in. Call unto me, and I will answer. Call unto me, and I will show you mighty things. How lovely are, how lovely are your ways, you leading me. You leading me. How lovely are your ways, you lead me in. Jesus, we love you. Yes. Hallelujah. Here you go. How lovely are your ways, you're leading me. How lovely are your ways, you lead me in. Your ways, you lead me in. Hallelujah. Well, you know, we may never sing it again, you know. Hallelujah. It's okay, because we'll just sing a new one. But they might as well get the words right while we're singing this one. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Are you just so happy? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. You're my wellspring, my fountain of life, my Redeemer, your ransom's price. How lovely are your ways, you leading me. How lovely are your ways, you lead me in. Hallelujah. How lovely are. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hatakira, Hakosarika, Mumbakili, Shepando, Marabaya, Mumbatana, Zeresi Katalama, Shebraha. Oh, how lovely are your ways, you leading me. Satori, Masatori, Masaya, Popanikete. How lovely are your ways, you lead me in. My wellspring, my fountain of life. Oh, my Redeemer, you are ransom's price. Oh, my Lord Jesus, you are my Christ. Woo. Ha, 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 ha. You know, the Spirit of the Lord allows us to worship Him with everything that is within us, with every emotion you've ever felt and beyond. With every passion you've ever felt and beyond. That's the first place that the floodgates of rivers open up or are supposed to. Katore nea pahasadea. Haramaketi labasata lalabahoko tikina nakataya. So that with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our spirit, with all of our strength, with all of our mind, with all that is within us, we begin to worship Him with the love, with the joy, with the peace, with the goodness of the Lord. Hallelujah. I worship the Lord with hunger. I worship the Lord with thirsting. I worship the Lord with strong cryings and supplications and intercessions by the Holy Ghost. So I long for you, Lord, like the deer for the water brook. I long for you, Lord, like a man in a thirsty land. You're my wellspring, woo, my fountain of life. You're my Redeemer, you are ransom's price. Come on, man. My Lord Jesus, you are my Christ. How lovely are your ways, you lead me. How lovely are your ways, you lead me in. Jesus, Jesus. Call unto me, and I will show you great and mighty things. Call unto me, and I will answer. And I will answer. How lovely are your ways, you leading me. Ah, but a cake to Kanemosha. But I dada and a guitar at Alabatara Alabakita. Maratara that I stick at Alabaharadaya. Have you ever prayed until you've lost the English language? Have you ever prayed till you're so raptured over in such joyous, inexpressible, glorious utterances of laughter? Have you ever prayed until you're broken with compassion and sobs of thanksgiving? I tell you, there's so much realm that God's people have never really ever entered in. Oh, I pray in Jesus' name tonight, you'll say, I'm going to engage. I pray tonight in the name of Jesus, you'll take a hold of that opportunity that's been given you that so few have ever entered into. So few have ever really entered in. So few have ever laid hold on these things. And God's waiting. God the Father stands out in front of us with all these piles of gifts, with all these glorious riches and spiritual blessings waiting for someone who desires the heavenly more than the earthly, desires the things of Christ more than the things of self. I'm pressing in. Hey, there's a glory about to be revealed in us. Hey, there's a glory about to be revealed in us. Hey, there's a glory about to be revealed in us. Present sufferings are not worthy to be compared to the glory that's about to be revealed in us. Beloved, now are ye the sons of God, and though it does not appear what you should be, you know that when you see him, you should be like him. You should see him as he is, for you should be like him. There's a glory that's about to be revealed in us. And everybody who has this hope purifies themselves even as he's pure. Yeah, there we can see the opportunity for all the things that belong to the desires of this world and the desires that people run after and the things that belong to the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye and the pride of life. And boy, does the pride of life, is the pride of life the friend of the people in the church. Oh, it's so subtle, very few can see it. You got to get really close to Father. You got to walk in the light as he's in the light to be able to see that foul and ruinous thing. But as we enter into this place, this realm of divine grace, in this realm of praise and of glory, hallelujah. As we begin to gaze upon him, we begin to recognize what he's made available to us, that these things aren't fairy tales, that they're the truth, that Christ Jesus is present, he's real, he's here, he's not absent. Then we begin to ponder and contemplate and think about the glory that's about to be revealed. We begin to think about the treasure that we have in these earthen vessels and this opportunity that we have to walk in God's grace and God's glory. And though we must labor, and though it's as though we must take a shovel at times and dig. You know, in the wilderness there were these moments and times where they would just speak to the rock and the water would flow out. Moses speak to the rock rather than the water flow out. But there was other times he said to the leaders, now you dig. And they took their staffs and they began to cry out, spring up, O well. Spring up, O well. And with their staffs they dig, and with their staffs and with their voice they cried, oh, spring up, O well. Spring up, O well. So many people are willing to live in a dry and thirsty land where there is no water, and all they needed to do was begin to cry out, spring up, O well. All they need to do is begin to move in faith, believing that God has meant what he said and he's faithful concerning his promises, and that you can always have an overwhelming glory of his presence in your life. You know, the other day, actually it was last night or this morning, I can't remember, last night and this morning kind of blended together when you get up at 4:50 in the morning, catch an airplane. And a person who's walked with the Lord, been a minister, been walking with the Lord quite some time, he said, please tell me. He's in a great Holy Ghost church. He said, please tell me that there's more than this. Please tell me that there's a way to go beyond that which we've seemed to settle out for. I said, oh, no. What's wrong? Here's what you're missing. You asking and desiring that which only you can find in Him. The church will set the foundation. The ministers of the gospel will give expression and give examples of that which God has supplied. But it is only on our knees in a one-to-one relationship with God that we can press beyond all those things that would be ordinary or common, or that which maybe even the best of the Holy Ghost churches in the land may have. And Father's intended it to be that way. That He may draw us into a place of oneness with Himself and there unveil to us all heaven's glory. I said there's a glory about to be revealed in us. There's a glory about to be revealed in you. Hallelujah. 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 You know, and I think about Harabokia. And see, you know, I understand that in comparison to the glory that we have received. Jesus said, Father, the glory you gave to me, I've given it to them. There is a glory that we have received. There is a glory when we walk around in this place where heaven feels the sound of our voice. How where the glory of God begins to rush over our soul, of our being, and begins to pour out of us with explosions of His expressions. There's glory to say to the blind, see the deaf hear, crippled walk, dead be raised to life again. There's a glory in commanding the wind and the waves and saying we're going to come into town, and when we do, even though it's the monsoon, it'll stop raining as soon as we land, and it will not rain again. Well, I never said it wouldn't rain again. I just said it'll stop raining when I get there. As we lifted off the ground, I didn't realize that Daniel and Joshua was with me when we did that. As we lifted up the airplane, lifted off the ground, the monsoon resumed. Here's a glory, divine power and authority to say to the oppressed, go free. Hallelujah. There's a divine glory to be captivated with the realms of the Spirit of the Lord as He reveals Jesus to us. But there's a glory that's about to be revealed in us. There's a glory that all creation groans and waits and travails in until this moment in time. To see the resurrected saints, to see God's plan ultimately fulfilled in man, to where that everything that Jesus is in His resurrected being, we get to partake of too. That which God intended when He created Adam in His image and in His likeness, and the purpose for him to go and eat the tree of life instead of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But it's a glory even beyond, because somebody said we restored that glory that Adam had. No. We are restored to the glory, hallelujah, that Christ Jesus possesses. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. A second man came. The last man came, brother. Huh? We don't say second because there could be a third if we say second. The last man came. The last one came. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. You can be seated. You know, God's doing great things. We're just so excited about the opportunities that we have. We're just so blessed because Brother Mike went and gave himself to the things that we're doing at the MTC, and he's amazing. I think he's already knocked on everybody's door. He's such an evangelist. He's already got a jail ministry, prison ministry going on in Lakeview. He's already got the police department asking him to be a part of their probation program. You know, it's wonderful when people got fire in their belly, man. They don't need to sit around. They don't need to have somebody instruct them, tell them, okay, now listen, you're going to be okay now. I promise you, God still loves you. He still loves you. I know I just told you this 5 minutes ago, but He still loves you, and you can just sit right there and just be happy. People just get out and great. You know, I was so blessed by him. He said, listen, I'm going to tell you right. I recognize this one day in the not too distant future. I'm going to stand before the Lord. And when He asked me, what did I do for Him? Huh? I'm going to have something to give. And we're preparing him right now to go to Kashmir. Hallelujah, Kashmir Valley. Hallelujah. He's right now babysitting his first 10,000 rainbow trout eggs. So I said, what is in that? Well, see, Kashmir, you die for the gospel if you don't know how to do it right. But when you go in there and you set up a McDonald's jar and you got 20, 30,000 rainbow trout eggs or steelhead eggs in there. And you know, everybody's already come around and watched the building go up. It starts off with 100 around there. They are looky-loos, I'm telling you right now. Then it's 1,000. huh? Then they're all in there, just they will sit there and they will stare at them eggs until they hatch. Because they can't believe those little teeny eggs are going to turn into trout that they can eat. It is just not even look possible. They're going to stare there. They'll stare there for 4 days. I was explaining to Mike, I said, what's going to happen? They're going to come in, they're going to stare. The place is going to be jam-packed. And you just tell everybody you're going to feed them a hot dog after the thing in the evening, at the end of the day. They've never eaten a hot dog in their life, probably. Or something. And every one of them except Jesus. You don't have 1,000 every day. 10,000 every day. So we can go spy out the land. Papa's got a divine connection. I'm going to walk in there and Papa's going to open the doors for me. Somebody said, well, did you think it through? No, I didn't. Not one thought other than I'm taking that land. That's all I thought about. We want to think everything through. Would you get over yourself? You blinded. If you think you can think through what God has planned, come on, man. If we were saved based upon our intelligence, we'd all be hopelessly lost. You know what I'm saying? God, the Holy Ghost, come to fill us up with the mind of Christ, to give us direction. Hallelujah. So we're getting ready to take off. We'll be gone this next week, and then we'll be back for a week, and then we're gone to Mississippi, Ocean Springs, Mississippi. I'm really looking forward to this. I'm going to go. There's a preacher there. Hallelujah. You're watching tonight. I love you very much. There's a preacher there that many years ago, he went out and he tried to walk on the water and he got discouraged. And he hadn't been doing much water walking for a long time. So by the help and the grace of God, we're going to come show you how to walk on the water again. Hallelujah. Don't get discouraged about it, man. Come on now. Faith will increase. People say, I want more anointing. Well, that's what Father wants. Because the anointing and an increase to the anointing is about the life and power of Jesus being revealed in us. That's it. You say, I want to increase the anointing. You're just saying, I want to increase in the life and power of Jesus to be revealed in me. That's all you're saying. And I'm going to tell you, Father's happy about it. Father's dancing over that. He said, Zephaniah 3:17, he says he dances over us. He rejoices over us. He writes songs about us. Huh? We treasured people to him. All his delights are with the sons of men. Huh? He's constantly saying, hey, where are you guys at? Where are you at? Adam, where are you? Jesus came. The Father came moving to the spirit of the day, crying out, Adam, where are you? Moving to the spirit of the day because there was new things to do. Huh? There were greater things to accomplish. Huh? He wanted to show him the expanse of all that his hands had made, which he had placed under his feet and given him dominion over it in a relationship of ruling and reigning with him. People, right now, God has purposed that you and I are ruling and reigning with him. He's made us, hallelujah. He's made us priests. That's Revelation 1:5. That's still in the church age. Are you with me? That's not Revelation chapter 4 and after these things. It is. Hallelujah. He's made us priests and kings. And we're reigning with him. And Paul said the same thing. John said it. Most everything you can find that Paul said, John said, Peter said it, and Jesus said it. Huh? If you follow my face post, you got that today, huh? Hallelujah. I pray, Annalyn, that no word of God will become an intellectual and mental exercise for you. But every word of God will be living word. It'll be living and it will be powerful. And that every word you read, you'll say, Lord, I want that. I got to have that. I can't live without it. If you'll do that, I'm going to tell you right now, it won't be long. It won't be long. There'll be things happening in your life that you can't even imagine. Too many people just read over it and then they prolong. They put God off. I mean, how many times you think about it? Think about it. If it's possible that there have been many opportunities that you've had to move into things with the Lord and something else came along and you got distracted by and you went after it. And you never even repented. You just kind of came back around when all of a sudden things weren't working out right for you and you needed Jesus a little bit more. Need some help. You made spiritual violations. He was a convenience. You listen to me? Tonight, I pray that he become your treasure. I pray that he'd become treasure hid in the field. You go sell everything to attain. I pray he'll become to you a pearl of great price. I pray that you'll let the Holy Spirit show you how wonderful he is, how much he loves you. how much he freely gives us all things. Freely gives us all things. It's amazing. If while we're yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. If God spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all. What a price. How much more shall he then freely give us all things by him? You begin to just sit down and you just start thinking, when all of a sudden it dawns on you that Father has purposed that all of us, not just some of us, but all of us, come to know what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and thereby be filled with all the fullness of God. Now think about that. If I should just be willing to contemplate just a little bit longer, investigate with a little bit more desperation and intensity, God would cause me to know the love of Christ that passes knowledge, that I would begin to understand how to participate in knowing the love of God. We know and believe the love that God has for us. God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, for as he is, so are we. That's freedom. That's knowing the love of Christ that passes knowledge. Sit there and contemplate, to investigate. People contemplate, investigate all kinds of things for their own profit. There's things which result in trinkets that you can have that rust and moth will destroy and corrupt, that are temporal. The Father's wanting us to come and desperately look on and desire and want more than anything else his kingdom and his righteousness. To desire more than anything else these wonderful gifts that he's made available to all the riches of his life. Hallelujah. And by his grace, he just, in his goodness, he just put the treasure on the inside of us, and we're still looking around outside. And he's put his treasure on the inside of us, and we're still looking around outside. The excellency of his glory is on the inside of us, and we're looking around outside for something else to fulfill rather than drinking of the fountain. Hallelujah. Now unto him who is able to do superabundantly above all that you can think or ask, according to this treasure, this power, this glory, this life is on the inside of us. Father, we thank you for the anointing. Just receive right now. Just receive. See, you have to be willing. Just receive. You have to be willing to let God come in and begin to instruct you. You know, the last time I was here, I believe it was, I talked a little bit, might not have been last time, but I talked about God's demand for obedience. Jesus learned obedience, and God's got a demand for obedience. And Hebrews chapter 12 sets it up, says, seeing you've got a great company, a great cloud of witnesses. Let us run this race with joy, laying aside the weight and the sin that so easily would so easily beset us, and run the race with joy, right? Look into the author and finisher of our faith. And then the Lord lays out for us the fact that, I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't get it, if you're like Esau, if you don't get it, if you've been born again and you've been washed in the blood and you're not willing to get it, and you're still going on in error just like Israel did, in disobedience and defiance and ignorance, he's going chasing you. And he didn't only said that. He said, I'll flog you too. He did. This is what he said. Hallelujah. I know your King James said scourge is to get flogged. I'm not interested in being flogged. I'd rather be instructed in the way as Jesus was. I don't be like a mule that needs a bridle. Hey, you listening to me? I didn't be like a fool that needs a whip. Come on. The Spirit of the Lord has come. The Spirit of the Lord is the spirit of obedience. Did you know that? I like him a whole lot better than I like the spirit of the devil, which is the spirit of disobedience. Spirit of obedience is far greater in power than the spirit of disobedience. You know, Adam transgressed and disobeyed, and because of that disobedience, death came, and sin by death. But something far greater happened through Christ Jesus' obedience. Huh? Through his obedience, hallelujah. Life came, and through that life being imparted, righteousness sprang up. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, his obedience is far better. It's far better. It's far more impactful, far greater than Adam's disobedience. Holy Ghost has come to teach you. Holy Ghost come. I'm amazed at God's long suffering. I'm amazed at his long suffering. I'm amazed at his forbearance. You know, I've come to a place over the past month, the Lord has made me radical. I'm not going to fully reveal how radical he's made me. You're just going to find out on your own. I'll tell you, the Lord just has turned it up. He's turned it up and turned it up. People come dedicate their babies, want me to dedicate their babies. I'm saying, you right now, you're resigning them and going to give them over to the church just like Hannah gave Samuel. And if you're not going to do that, then you go sit back down. Huh? People don't want to give their children over to the church. They want to run interference. They think that they got all the motherly and fatherly instincts that are needed for the kingdom of God. Not so. God gives anointings. Hallelujah. And I'm not Eli. Praise God. I'm not fat. I'm not blind. And I'm not disobedient. Praise God. Neither am I Hophni and Phinehas. Praise the Lord. Doing what they did. Huh? You with me? Hallelujah. Praise God. I'm a faithful servant of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Just lift your hands towards heaven. How's your body doing? I break the power of that affliction off you and that torment in Jesus' name. Your foul spirit of affliction, try to shut down the thyroid. Your foul spirit of hell, I bind you now in Jesus' name. That's beautiful. That is beautiful, guys. But you keep doing that, I'm just going to prophesy all night. I'm going to lay hands on everybody in the place. And I enjoy Holy Ghost meetings where we just do that, just minister to everybody. But see, people need to be taught in the way. And I mean, just you need to grab a hold of the word of life. And start, and you know, because you saying in your heart, I want to do this. I want to live this. Everything you read in the Bible, you don't just sit there and read. Everything, you know, you have to, I praise God for all the people who give themselves to reading the Word. But everything you read, you got to say, Lord, I want that. I want to do that. Strengthen me, empower me. I got to have that. I got to have that. And get covetousness and get greedy with God. And I got to have that. And I got to have that too. And I thank you that you've given me this. And I thank you that you've given this other thing over here. Hallelujah. And I'm going to do it. I'm going to get up and go right now. Hallelujah. There's times that I've gone, Ann and I were going to go in 1985. We were going to go to China. I felt so strong about going to China in 1985. China had just opened up to educators, and Ann and I were educated. And we had received our degrees, and we had the goods. We were just what they were wanting. And I thought, Lord, I want to do this. And the Lord said, no, you can't do it. I just want to go, I wanted to go and just do it all. I want to go in all the world. I'd been preaching on the streets by that time for about 4 or 5 years and been ministering every place I had opportunity to minister, from Calvary Chapel to the schools to wherever else, to the church. And I was ready to go now to the nations, And the Lord says, no, you can't go. You got to stay in San Diego and you got to talk to those folks. And 1991, I said, I'm done. I'm going. And a man of God came and said, so if the people of God are going to wander around in the wilderness for 40 years, are you going to wander around with them? I said, absolutely not. I'm out of here. Somebody else can take over. You want it? I'm not interested. And then I said, yes, Lord, I will. So long as there's a generation. Hallelujah. So long as I get to look for somebody who's not going to go spend their life doing something other, than giving it to the kingdom. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Tokara sepedira hast. Mandelepe kiste pitoro susa. So tonight, I'll just break off those things off of you. I wanted to give you a heavenly vision. Once you begin to understand how to move in the authority of God. Yes. Hallelujah. I want you to open up your Bibles. I believe it's Mark chapter 13, verse 34. And if I'm wrong, I'll open up the Bible and look at it for a few minutes and find out exactly where I want to be. But the Son of Man is someone who went on a journey into a faraway place. And he left his house. You just listening to me. He left his house. And to his servants, he gave charge to his servants over all of his things. And each one, he gave each workman, he set to their work. And to the porters, he said, watch. Huh? So when we begin to think about this, there's an important word that I left out there. And that important word that I left out there is authority. Huh? And he gave what to his servants? Authority. And to every man his work. And to the porters he said, watch. And you and I get to have all of that fulfilled, all of that within our own life, in the context of our life. But yeah, there is a multiplicity of ministry, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that tonight, and I want to help you begin to understand some of the things that God has left charge for you and in charge of, and I want to show you that there's no threshold and there are no limitations for you, and I want you to get hungry and thirsty, because you're not going to get anything from Father until you get desperate and you go to banging.
Amen.
And screaming out, saying, get up in there.
Amen.
Get up and give me this right now. Read Luke chapter 11.
Amen.
And bang it a little harder. That's why the way this how somebody said, I don't like that. Well, God likes it. This is why he wants it.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Everything he's got for us is free. It's a gift, but it's still nonetheless sacred. And the only way that you and I are not going to violate and profane the sacred is because we desperately got to have it and can't live without it, not going away, nor being denied. Hallelujah. Come on now. I watch. I'm just seeing, Jacob hanging on God and God saying, let me go. And Jacob saying no. And God's got a smile on his face. I'm not letting you go till you bless me. Hallelujah. And that's why the Lord was even known in Deuteronomy as God who dwells in the bush. Huh? Because it harkens back to God being there in the bush, and kind of sneaking up on Jacob and tackling him. And in his worst and most distressing moment, when he thinks he's going to get killed by his brother Esau, and he's going to lose everything, and his little children, and his two wives and the concubines and all the servants and everybody's frail, and he thinks, my goodness, this is a difficult time for God to jump out and start tackling me, start roughing me up. I need a little bit of comfort and tender time here. Hallelujah. Oh yeah. Well, listen, ain't no time for that comfort stuff that way. God give you enough comfort. And is there in Luke chapter 11 that the Lord's saying, he's saying, I want you to bang. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not going to get up because you're my friend. I'm not going to get up and get those things for you just because you've been born again. I'm going to get up and get them for you because you will not leave me alone.
Amen.
Because of your boldness.
Amen.
And he says, ask, seek, and knock. People just tell on and on about what ask, seek, and knock is. You know what ask, seek, and knock means? You demand. That's what that means. You're placing a demand upon God. Hallelujah. Parasuta le feya. Pasata la mongeya ha teya. You dang on bo chica te rushita. You rasu nambisi komande. You place a demand upon God and you're going to be left without? No. Ha. No. The Father is waiting for these things to take place. He's waiting for you to turn to Him and say to Him, you my wellspring, my fountain of life. He's waiting for you to look at Him and cry out and call unto Him so that He can answer you. To where you don't let up. You cry all the more. When you're needy and you know that Christ Jesus is around, you know God's around, you know He's here. And you don't have what you want, and you don't have what you need, what do? Just act like blind Bartimaeus. He's more anointed, as it seems. More desperate than so many of God's people today. He cried all the more. Jesus, you son of David, have mercy upon me. As much and very similar to the prayer that Moses prayed. Oh God, have mercy upon me. Show me your glory. I must see your glory now. You You know, Jesus said also in similar fashion to this that we read here in Mark chapter 13 and verse 35. He says in Matthew chapter 25 that he gave those things which belonged to him, he gave them to each man according to their several ability and their individual ability. To one he gave one, as we would say, talent. But it's not a talent in the way that people would try to express it. It has to do with what he was doing, his work, his ministry, the things that he was actively involved in, because he's going away. He's the Son of Man is one who goes upon a long journey or goes to a faraway place, and he gives authority. He gave power. He gave abilities. Literally, that's what with the talent, the riches of the Spirit, abilities. One he gave one, to the other he gave two, to another he gave five. And he said, I want you to take my stuff and I want you to occupy. God has purposed that we become fruitful and we begin to understand what does it look like to be fruitful in God. Well, to be fruitful in God, first and foremost, all we've got to do is understand John chapter 15. He says, come and abide in me. And so he said, and literally, I mean, that should be so empowering. Somebody said, oh, just, you know, this task. It is not a task. The table of the Lord is not contemptible. It's not a burden. It is a privilege and opportunity to be able to lay hold on God, to live our life for the kingdom, to every day be active about the Father's will and about the Master's business, you know. It is an amazing response that many people have that's just another task. It's another task because you are so wrapped up in your worldly stuff. It's another task because you so wrapped around your possessions and your interests and your earthly cares. Because it's supposed to be the other way around. I don't have time to go to work. I don't have time to see I don't want to pay no more bills. I'm going bankrupt in earth and I'm going to get the riches of heaven. No, listen to me. I'm talking to you about the way it's supposed to work out. About the authority that, come on, man, I got to see some of you. You look like you got, you know, beanstalks growing out of ears. Praise God, I got an axe with me. You want to chop those things out so you can hear? I got a knife. I got a sword of the Spirit. I'm going to do some circumcision of ears tonight. And we're going to cut off that foreskin in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Circumcise your ears so you can hear instead of just sitting there nodding your head. Don't ever do anything with it. Sometimes I think the nodding of the head means that it's dead. It's empty. Come on, people. God's people say amen, stuff like that. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. I want that. Praise the Lord. Amen. It all acknowledged by the nodding of the head. That's not true. It's not true. You reach out and you take these for the, you know, salvation. You know, it doesn't say the nodding of the head is made unto salvation. Does Scripture not say that? It says the confession of the mouth is made unto salvation. You reach out and you take it now. You speak it out. It's time that you start being a true prophet to yourself. Many people are a false prophet to themselves. A false prophet is someone who speaks other things than what God has said and declares them to be true. Huh? Yes. I hear people speaking all kinds of things contrary to the Word of God and the ways of God. Quit being a false prophet to yourself. Come on, be a faithful prophet. Yes. Of the Word of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord empowers us. I mean, he says, come and live with me. Give me a break. People said, oh God, I want to be with you. He's saying, I want you to be with me too. Stop being doubtful and unbelieving and come get over in here. Come dwell in me. So I can start walking around. I'm dwelling in God. Hallelujah. And God's dwelling in me. I'm in him and he's in me. You know? Hallelujah. He empowered us, man. That's an empowerment. God's never asked us to do anything except he gave us the power to do it. I can show you that and prove that to you over and over again. But one of the verses of Scripture that I love to use to prove that is that he says, and Peter says, and go ahead, take another drink. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3, he says to us this. According to his divine power, he gave us the ability. According to his divine power, he gave us all things that pertain to his life and his godliness. Because we're not talking about no other life. We're not talking about our own personal life. Amen. Now I'm empowering you to go do whatever you want to do. That's not, you know, come on. No!
Father's called us. I mean, the high plan of authority is found in this. It's found in doing the will of the Father. That is the realm of asking what you will. Because you live to do the will of the Father, and you're going to get whatever you ask.
Amen.
And that's how simple God made explosive, glorious faith.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm asking God for the nations. I'm asking God for the uttermost parts of the earth. I wonder if people have a prayer life. Then I wonder what it is they're praying. People need to pray a little bit more about maturity in the Holy Ghost. You pray the prayer of faith and you're going to get it. It's going to take 30 years. And begin to pray and cry out to God for souls. God would give you the ability and the power to speak His word of life, that His anointing would be expressed to you and be like a piercing, slicing sword of the Spirit that reveals the thought and the intent of the heart. Where the sound of your voice becomes filled with convicting power of the Holy Ghost. Your people, if you just you get passionate about these things.
Yes. Amen.
I'm passionate about
Amen.
These things. I talk to the Father the way I'm talking to you right now. Prayer hits me and it comes just, it booms. I don't know anything about whisper a prayer in the morning. Whisper a prayer at noon. Whisper a prayer in the evening. Keep your heart in tune. It's nonsense. I tell you right now, that song wasn't born in revival. That song wasn't born in no revival. Whisper no prayer. Cry. Call unto me. God said, I'll answer. He said nothing about no whispers. Jesus, help us. We got all the ideas and they're wrong. You know, we need to go ahead and get Father's ideas. He empowers us. You come and dwell in Him. And there He says, dwelling in Him, if we're dwelling in Him, then we're going to produce these fruits.
Amen.
According to His divine power, I said that. According to His divine power, He's given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. Why? Because He's called us to produce something.
Yes.
Glory and purity. Glory and purity. Glory and purity. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He's given us a divine ability within that glory and purity to add all the characters and the nature and the disposition, the majesty of His own nature, to give all attendance to it. And if we do, then He ministers to us an entrance into the realms of His kingdom so that we can start commanding the wind and the waves, so we can start speaking to the nations and calling them into the kingdom and start with individuals that are around us and start with our own households.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
My goodness gracious, I didn't have to ask the Lord, give me dreams and visions about my children so I could have discernment and know where they were at before they got there. I got that just as a default because I walk with God. Hallelujah. You walk with God and you're going to have dreams and visions and you're going to have the inside scoop on what's going on in your house.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Come on, people. Why don't you get baptized in the Holy Ghost? Why don't you step into Pentecost with wisdom and with understanding? Hallelujah. Why don't you quit sighing and start getting yourself some courage and some boldness in the Holy Ghost? Why don't you quit being sorrowful? Start being glad. Why don't you stop being of a doubtful disposition and get yourself some faith? God, the Holy Ghost is handing it out for free. He's handing it out for free right here. He get it out for free. He says, all these riches, and He's just giving them away. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. I was thinking today, you know, I got finished ministering to this guy who gave me, taxi cab driver gave me a ride from the airport. I was thinking after I got finished ministering to him, I'm in heaven, came down in the car. We broke off every power of darkness that could be broken. We released him to be able to walk with Jesus if he wanted. And I thought, man, I wish I had a whole lot of money so I could give people gift cards and just hand them a gift card for $100,000. So I just want to bless you with this. What is this? Oh, it's a gift card for $100,000. Well, what are you giving me this? I don't deserve it. Well, I just want to show you what Jesus has done for us. It's a small token what God's done for us. I guarantee you he'd go spend it. I guarantee if I gave you a gift card, you gave me a gift card. I go spend that thing. I'm not going to sit around and go, oh, look at this gift card. I think I'm going to frame it. I'm going to paste it in my Bible in the back and just kind of stare at it. Think about the fact there's $100,000 in there in that gift card. I'm going to go spend it. I'll spend that so quick. Papa's giving us the riches of his glory. He's given to us. He has taken everything that he has and he's placed it. He's given us his authority. When we think about his authority, he had the ability, he had such authority, everybody was amazed that he commanded the unclean spirits with his word and they obeyed him and they wondered and said, what kind of authority is this? He gives the same authority, gave the same authority to his 12 disciples and to his 70 others. And he gave the same authority to you and me. And he says, anyone at any time, anyone who believes, you can begin to function in this wonderful divine power and authority. You get the measure of how far you're willing to go with God. If all you're going to do is serve God at your workplace, that's all you're going to get. You're going to get a measure for your workplace. Huh? Poor you. If you're going to go ahead and obey God, huh? Yes. You're going to begin to intercede for where his heart's at, for a lost and dying world. Hmm? You're going to begin to cry out to God to make you fruitful. You say, God, I'm tired of being barren. Yes. Hmm? I'll tell you right now, you can sit there and pray all you want. Oh, God, I'm tired of being barren. But until you get up and start doing exactly what he already told you to do, ain't nothing going to happen. Huh? When you begin to go, now all of a sudden you need. Lord, I laid my hands on some people the other night, and they were all crippled up. And the Lord, they didn't straighten up in front of me. And Father, I want them to straighten up in front of me. Father, I dealt the other night with some people that were demon-possessed, and I did not see the thing break through. And I can have all of my explanations as why they may not have broke through, but I don't want that. I just want a greater display of your power, that I don't care what they look like. If it's a demon-possessed man who's got legions, that's like 6,400 devils. That's about a legion. 6,400 devils. Huh? He cutting himself. He was one terrible mess. Huh? I mean, he started running at most Christians and they're going to take off, run the other way and dial 911 on their cell phone and said, send the National Guard. Send help quickly. I'm going to be killed. Man, God said that, well, you mean if somebody comes to my house and my church starts calling and causing problems, I have a person ready. If one's got a gun, the other's got a 911, and we're going to take care of them. I mean, just like, could you please show me where that verse of scripture is? Gun, 911. I mean, this is powerless. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to get in the scrap. I'm going to be right in the midst of it. Yeah. I'm not going to back down. Somebody says, hey, look, you got to come up here and pray for this person. It may look really, really bad. I'm going to jump on it. I'm going to jump on it. Somebody said, well, I don't really feel the special anointing for that. I'm going to tell you right now, forget about that. God's commanded this opportunity has presented itself, and we about the work of the ministry. I mean, this is the wonderful life, dear people. This wonderful life of living for Jesus and finding our whole existence wrapped up in the ministry of the kingdom. And you know, maybe you're part-time in the kingdom. I was part-time in the kingdom in some respects because I worked part-time and then pastored part-time. And then basically took care of, you know, the finances as much as anyone else in the church and took care of my own finances because of the way things were at the time. And, you know, and I guarantee you I wasn't a silent witness. I guarantee you everybody around me knew what was going on with my life. Huh? Hallelujah. We get banner shirts that said Jesus' blood on the back cleanses from all sin. I mean, just every way we can, you know, put stickers up. What should it profit a man if he gains the whole world but lose his own soul? Have an opportunity. Pray every lunch. Is most every lunch, just go for a prayer meeting. Don't need to eat anyways. Been eating way too much anyways. We need to fast more. God's people need to fast more. People say, you know, because we start moving in the authority, but God's given us power to move in the authority, but sometimes we don't find strength because people running interruption. Because I believe every word of God is powerful. It's living. It's there for. It's there, and it means. There's a special meaning. God uses special words to convey the special meaning. And that's why, you know, actually when the demon-possessed father came and he said, I brought my son to your disciples, and they had no iskus, no strength to cast out the devil. And King James says they were not able. And that's a poor translation. I like to go ahead and express what's there. Because iskus is a very important word. It's contrasted to dunamis. They had dunamis. They received dunamis. They received divine power. They just didn't have the strength to function in the dunamis that God had gave them, because the Pharisees and the scribes were arguing with them, and they had all kinds of ideas, and who knows, just probably freaking out. This kid's throwing himself in the fire, throwing himself in the water, and they were all excited about how they had authority over demon spirits through the name. They were, how the devils were subject to them through his name. And the Lord just says, hey, don't get too excited about that. That's just ordinary. That's just ordinary everyday believers. Hallelujah. Come on, people, I want you to get this.
Amen.
I want you to look like this and act like this, because the Son of Man is one who's gone on a far journey and given authority to his servants. He's given some, he's given one, as it were, one portion of his ability according to their several individual abilities. To another, he's given a double of his ability, and to another, he's given, you know, fivefold of his ability, as it were. And he's expecting you and I to multiply it, to see increase come in it.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now, he comes and he says, oh, he comes finds you and you saying, well, you know, you just had too big of expectations for us. How do you expect us? We just normal everyday people to be functioning in the supernatural. I mean, what do you think? So I just took that which you gave me and hid it in the earth so that you would have what belongs to you when you return. Because I really had more important fish to fry than your kingdom. I had more things going on in my life than to just be all the time in church. No, that's what he said. That was what that steward said. That servant said. Huh? Come on, people. I don't want anybody to run the risk for that. I was too busy with my job. You said that we were supposed to be fervent in business. One verse of scripture up against 1,000 to run with the anointing, you know? You said that if we don't provide for our own, we're worse than infidel. He also told you about 10,000 other things to do that all had an agreement of going and trusting God and let Father be your provider. Hello. And you read, I mean, people need to read those verses of scripture in view of Matthew chapter 6. Give me a break. Don't go seeking after all these things, what you should wear, what you should eat. Take no thought for them. You know, come on, get some scriptures lined up together. Are you listening to me? Give me a break. I mean, come on, we've got more intelligence than that. Hallelujah. Plus, God gave us wisdom. Ha! You know, I got the Spirit of God. I got the Spirit of wisdom. I got the Spirit of understanding. I got the Spirit of might. I got the Spirit of counsel. I got the Spirit of knowledge and the Spirit of the fear of the Lord. And I'm real excited about it. And I figure I'm going to spend mine. I'm going to use mine. I'm going to learn how to function in mine. I tell you, I got the keys of this equipment over here. And I'm not going to sit and stare at it. I'm going to get up on the thing and start learning how it works. I'm going to start moving gears. I might go off into the ditch a couple of times, but I'm going to get this thing right. Come on, people. I might lay hands on a couple of people from time to time that doesn't seem like they get healed. But I'm going to press into greater miracles. I'm not letting up. I'm not going to be discouraged. I'm going to tell you right now, even in the natural, I'm a fighter. I'm going to tell you, when God the Holy Ghost came on the inside of me, I became a Holy Ghost fighter.
Amen.
A fiery fighter.
Amen.
To fight a good fight of faith. I mean, when we ran races in school, we didn't run for second place. I did not like to get beat. I didn't care if my lungs came out of my mouth. Listen to me. Come on, man. Come on. Come on. I mean, there's got to be some fight and some passion on the inside of it. You know, the Lord said that's where his rivers, that's where the rivers of his person, the rivers of his glory, the rivers of his power would be expressed through our belly, the Greek word kolia, which literally means passions and emotions. In other words, it's a Greek application, an added Greek application for passions and emotions.
Amen.
Somehow, I want to look at people and they're like, I don't know, maybe they watch too much Star Trek when they're little and they identified with Spock, you know? they thought this, no, it's really actually religious influences, because many religions, they, in their realms of their demonic worship, it's all about being sedate and sorrowful and sad and oppressed and depressed. Hallelujah. There's too many oppressed and depressed Christians. They're not possessed. They're just oppressed and depressed, afflicted and tormented and tossed. I'm tell you right now, ain't nothing going to touch me like that. I'm going to bust it off. I know how to take hold of God and bust that stuff off. And you need to, listen, we give you an example. You're not in some Baptist church and have been left out of the flow of divine power and authority and examples. You're not in some, you know, Episcopal Lutheran church or whatever. Huh? Watching somebody stand around in a gown giving you a liturgical thing. You need to hear someplace showing somebody going after the things of the Spirit and going doing things around the earth. You have no excuse. You're without excuse. You've got witnesses that this is a reality, that what God said yesterday is the same today, because He's no different. A day is the same as 1,000 years with Him, the same as 10,000, 100,000. He doesn't change. Hallelujah. God of New Testament feels exactly the same way He did in the Old Testament. Hallelujah. Praise God. He's imparted life to us. See, if righteousness could have come by the... if the law could have imparted life, then righteousness would have been by the law. But the law was powerless to impart life. Jesus had to come and do that which only He could do, so the powers of death could be broken and He could impart... He could release the Holy Ghost who come work a miracle of impartation of the life of God into you and me. Hallelujah. I'm walking around with the supernatural power of the living God. I'm walking around God's tabernacle and on the inside of me. Hallelujah. 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 I was telling the Lord the other day, Lord, you got to do it now. And the more I said that, the stronger the anointing came. Some more rush of the Holy Ghost came. Father gets happy about that. If it be thy will. If it be thy will, that's a cop out, you lying. Because God's already shown what His will is. He showed what His will is. He showed His will that we're supposed to live in divine health. By His stripes, we were healed. That means we're supposed to live in divine health. And I can give you more scriptures than that. I mean, because I'm telling you right now, healing is the children's bread. That's like what? That's cereal for breakfast. It's just bread. How often do you eat bread? When you say, give us this day our daily bread, you're actually saying, give us this day our healing and all our need and all provision. Because He's our suzerain. He is our provider, protector, and perfecter. He's everything to us. He's our shield and our exceeding great reward. The word shield is the word that we would understand in the context of suzerain, which means benefactor. Benefactor, the benevolent benefactor who is by means of a covenant bound to us, has bound Himself to be our protector, has bound Himself by covenant to be our provider, has bound Himself by covenant to be our perfecter, to have everything that He has and give it to us because He delights in sharing it. Well, then if you believe that, you should never or another day live expecting a paycheck. You should begin to live by faith. You should never again expect somebody to give you money in a bank account through a paycheck. Come on, step on up. Step on up. Wean yourself a dependency upon the arm of flesh so you can start moving in the things of the Spirit. As long as you trust in horses and chariots, it's going to be very difficult for you to trust in God. The Lord says, take no thought concerning these things, but go after the kingdom. There's a kingdom authority that you have. The kingdom of God suffers violence. The violent kick the door down. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Praise God, I know you are. Hallelujah. You just don't diddle dally around. Don't get yourself over there in the baby pool, huh? Just soaking. Get out in the storm. Get out in the storm. And don't tread no water, huh? Go for an exercise swim. Are you listening to me, huh? Come on, people. You know, it's Caleb and Joshua. Those giants, they'll be our breakfast food. That's what they said. There's not everybody wants to be pretend they Caleb's and Joshua's, but it's just evidence that many people aren't willing to step in and risk their life for the inheritance. God has given us inheritance. He gave us a birthright.
Yes.
Jacob was not willing to only have the birthright. He risked his life to have the inheritance too. And Father was blessed by it. And Father was pleased by it. Now, all people want to talk about that, you know, Jacob was a supplanter and a deceiver. No, he was a heel grabber. He was a heel grabber. He said, why should I work when I can just grab your heel? Pull me out. Because that's what Yaakov means. Yaakov means one who grabs the heel. Hallelujah. And besides that, it wasn't his idea. It was his mama's. Because his mama knew, because mama had already heard from God. You understand? Did you read the text? God had already told mama how it was going to happen. Huh? The elders had served the younger. Hallelujah. Because she wasn't going to stand by and watch Esau been playing the fool long enough, sold his birthright for a pot of beans, went up there and married a bunch of Hittite women. Huh? Had no care, shamed his dad, was rebellious. It was obvious. He ain't the inheritor. He don't even care about, you can't have the inheritance without the birthright anyway. You got to have the birthright to get the inheritance. God's made us heirs. That's an authority. A co-inheritor with Jesus. And you say, oh, well, that's for heaven. You know, that's going to be in heaven too, because I'm telling you, there's even greater glory going to be revealed. Praise God for that. But we have an heirship or a co-inheritorship in the same dimension of the heirship that Jesus displayed. He displayed the glory and the power of the Father. Hallelujah. But in displaying the glory and the power of the Father with the Spirit without measure, the first person ever, he still said, Father, glorify me with the glory that I had with you before there was anything. Ooh, there's some glory about to be revealed in us. Amen. Huh? Because I tell you, our whole existence is in him. I get to hear Father say to me every day, well done, my good and faithful servant. Huh? Huh? I get to hear Father say every day to me, this is my beloved son. You know why? Because I'm in Jesus. I don't exist outside of him. I don't have any, there's no place outside of Jesus. You're going to get in Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus, come dwell in me. Hallelujah. If you dwell in me and touch with total dependence. Dwelling in me. It's not, he didn't talk about some artwork, some, you know, bronze sculpture. He talked about a living organism of a branch depending upon the vine. As a branch dwells in the vine. He's talking to us about being so connected, so one. You can't separate the two. The both are dependent upon the other. A vine can't exist without the branch, and a branch can't exist without the vine. Is that radical or what? People said Jesus' ministry's over. Hey, if the church isn't willing to function in his ministry, then yeah, his ministry's over. And if his ministry is over, then the world's lost. And there's no hope. And see, but for me, I've already dealt with this. It's as though I've already been translated over there to give an account for my soul. I know that he's going to hold me accountable for the ministry of Jesus in my generation. I don't have any more time to waste. I'm 57 years old, and praise the God that I get to live to be 120. I got a lot of work to do. I'm not going to limit it to 120. I just figure these are the days we should see some people living like Methuselah. You know what I'm saying? I don't know how long it's going to be yet. There's a lot of things. I got a new book coming out. I'll lay it out for you. I mean, I've had different scholars look at the book that Charisma is publishing for me right now, and they go, look, you know what? You need to be commended, because all this is the scripture. You're going to have a hard time saying that those things that we laid out there, that they aren't true. And there's a lot of things that, lots of events that are going to happen. A lot of things got to be changed before the tribulation, before the man of sin is going to be revealed, huh? I don't know how much longer this is going to be, but I'm going to tell you right now, I want to get into this thing and be a part of the 3 billion people that have not heard. I'm not going to sit on the sidelines, do some little thing. I'm just here to do some little thing. My goodness gracious. Come on. That's not passion. That's like silly. What's, you know?
No, thank you.
What's my birthright if I'm hungry? What's my birthright mean to me if I die? I mean, you know, well, come on, give me a break. A bowl of beans ain't going to make the difference between life and death.
No. Right.
I mean, that's just nothing but lust. Are you with me?
Yeah.
I didn't buy into that. It wasn't a matter of life and death. You're going to, come on, goodness gracious. Jesus, help us. Quit acting like that. And that's why in Hebrews chapter 12, and the Lord's dealing with this, Esau's highlighted. He says, because, he after that, he lost out on everything, and he suddenly wakes up, I've lost out on everything. He's like a person wakes up in hell. Uh-oh. I squandered my birthright, I squandered my inheritance, I squandered a divine opportunity. Dear people, I can just convince you tonight that you have the privilege of living bigger for God than you will ever have an opportunity for the rest of eternity.
Yes.
When we're going to step over, I mean, listen, one of the things I like to say to people is, do you know that you live forever? And everybody's like, you're living forever.
Amen.
So when you pass from this life, you go into the next life. This life is just a preparation for the next life. And unless you have Jesus, you're going to spend eternity in a place called the lake of fire. They can say they don't believe that. All they want, you know what? I already got you.
Right.
You are already hooked. Too late. Because that's going to burn in your belly. That's going to burn in your mind because the Holy Ghost is going to make sure that it happens. Are you with me? I want you to do those things. I want you to get yourself some authority. Huh? And then when they say, I don't believe that, say, well, you know what I'm going to do right now? I'm going to take authority over every mind-blinding spirit right now in the name of Jesus. And from now on, you're not going to be deceived walking around under the authority of a liar and a spirit of a lie. Now you're somebody with some authority. Now you're somebody who's going to open up some prison doors. You're going to release some people from prison. Praise God. Instead of asking, come on right around asking, would you like to know something about Jesus? You scribe. You scribe. You Pharisee. Get yourself some boldness. Come on, get yourself some authority. God gave us charge to set the captives free. He gave us charge to turn people. Paul said, when he was addressing Felix, he said, I received a heavenly vision. I received a charge. I received an authority from God to turn people from Satan to God, from darkness to light, to open up the eyes of the blind. And he's talking spiritually there. Huh? That's the charge that the Lord has given. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you and me because he's anointed us. Because there's not a different ministry than Jesus. We cannot have a different ministry of Jesus. Otherwise, we're in another religion. Huh? If we don't have his faith, we're not in the faith. If we don't have his ministry, there's not another one. There's not another Jesus. Some people go and preach another Jesus. But we're going to preach the same Jesus who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Who is now King of heaven and a King of earth. Who's now exalted above all principality and power and might. He's not waiting to be king. He's already king, people. Hello. He's already the ruler, the absolute sovereign ruler. Nobody twitches, winks unless he gives permission. Breathes. Anything. He reigns in the kingdom of men, absolutely, sovereignly. Yeah. And you and I are reigning together with him. We reign in this life by one, even Christ Jesus. That was Paul's conclusion in Romans chapter 5. When he laid out the things that were against us and now the things that are for us. The things that we were deprived of and didn't have and now the things that we've been richly blessed with and given. Hallelujah. The things that fell upon us because of Adam's sin and the things that we've inherited because of Christ Jesus' righteousness. I mean, we just got to lay hold on eternal life. We got to lay hold on these riches. We got to take them up and recognize that we've been given the ability to speak them out by the grace of God and live in this authority. Quit diddle-dallying around. Huh? You got some fear and torment. You got authority over unclean spirits. You tell that thing to go now in Jesus' name. You got a pain in your body. You say, straighten up right now. I command you, body, obey God. Hallelujah. And, you know, especially when you're there in the throes of temptation. That's the time that we get to step into a greater realm of divine ability. Because in that press where Satan's taking everything he's got, he's coming at us with everything he got. Well, he's not coming at us with everything he got. He's coming at us with whatever, you know, the Lord allows, and for most people that ain't much. You know what I'm saying? Most people are constantly taken out by a stick devil, blind in both eyes, deaf in both ears, you know. Ears, you know, paraplegic, paralyzed from the neck down, can't hardly even breathe. You know, just grasping for air. And he takes us out, right, left, and center. It's got to stop, you know. But because I'm telling you, listen, when we step into that place of authority and we engage in authority over sin and over the works of Satan, where Satan is trying to come and take mastery over our life, trying to, as it were, neutralize the authority that's been given in life. And we recognize, man, we in a fight. This is a spiritual warfare. Satan's trying to come here, shove us around, tell us that he's in charge. Here, try some of my poison. Try some of my death. I know you want it. I know you got to have my pleasures. This is how I brand men and make slaves out of them. This is how I hunt men with my net of iniquity. Huh? This Nimrod just lived out the satanic realm, that's all. Alexander the Great just lived out the satanic realm, that's all. Hitler just lived out the satanic realm, that's all. There's so many other men the same way. Why are you going to let the enemy of your soul lie to you and deceive you and strip you of your authority? How are you listening to me? You need to read Romans chapter 6 if you don't understand what I'm talking about. Not me. I'm engaged in a fight. Huh? Hallelujah. Come on, I'm going to get strong. I'm going to be strong in strength of the Lord. That's an empowerment. It's not like, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. Please come, help, 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 help. He's given power to us to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. Hallelujah. To take into ourselves his armor. Hallelujah. It's not Saul's armor, it's his armor. His armor works. Hallelujah. And two of those very important parts of his armor that I feel that people don't even understand how to function in is the shield of faith. People get some little doubt come against them and they believe it's the truth. Yep, I figured so. I was just waiting for that to happen. Some little problem, some little issue, some little thing said in the sermon that you take offense to, and you're just, you have no shield of faith whatsoever. Yeah, none. They don't even know. You don't even know where it's at. You have once used it. You can't find it. I mean, come on, people. The shield of faith quenches every fiery dart of the wicked one, so you don't ever come under the influence of the mind of Satan or the mind of demon or the influence of demonic powers. Listen to me. We're supposed to be walking in the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit. That's the Word of God. Somebody said, oh, the Old Testament's not really, you know, effective anymore. Jesus took the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 8:3, and took on Satan with the best that he had to give, huh? And totally destroyed and defeated him. Huh? With man should not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. He's telling us something. You want to live a victorious life? You want to understand the life of the overcomer? You want to understand how to beat Satan coming and going? Anybody try him? He tries to get at you. He can't get at you. He's so frustrated, he gives up and goes home. Instead of the Christian getting so frustrated and giving up and going home. I hear people say, you know, I just don't feel like I can make it anymore. Listen, what are you talking about? Now that God could say that. God could say, I'm just going to give up. It just isn't working out. But you, how can you say that? I mean, come on. You've got a faithful God that is there constantly trying to get your attention, to empower you with all of his divine ability. You're going to give up. Help us, Lord Jesus. The Lord didn't get the brightest and the best. Poor father. Oh, Jesus, he got us. We need help. Praise God, he sent some help, amen. And if we'll just start relying on him, you know, we can start stepping up here instead of looking like a bunch of people that belong in medicated or something. You know what I'm saying? In need of just continual ongoing, you know, psychological counseling. Come on, people. Come on now. You don't like that? It's because the pride of life got you captivated. Because you're under the stronghold of the power of the pride of life. You need to get broken. Amen. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. You can find out real quick whether or not you humbled under the mighty hand of God. You know why? Because you're going to get exalted. Hallelujah. Aha. In due time. When it's all worked out right. Amen. When you quit wiggling. Are you with me? Are you with me? Under the mighty hand of God, start off with you wiggling all over the place. You squirming all over. You're squealing like a puppy being held for the first time. Are you listening to me? It's true. It's true. And then that hand going to be right there. And you can scream and holler and say, I don't want you anymore. I'm not listening to you anymore. And he'll let you go. But if you humble yourself under the hand of God, he'll stay right there till you quit wiggling. Then he'll take you. And he exalts you because you're already seated with him in the heavenly realm. That was gifted to us just like righteousness was gifted to us, just like the new birth, the new creation was gifted to us, just like the Holy Ghost was gifted to us, just like we being made the temple of God was gifted to us. Oh, the miracle. The miracle. The miracle of the new birth, the miracle of the washing of the water, regeneration, renewing of the Holy Ghost, the miracle of being crucified together with Christ. Somebody said, it's a substitutionary offering. You've been spinning your propeller way too long. You've been thinking way too hard. I am crucified with Christ. It's a miracle, wonderful participation of union in death, that the old man might be put to death and crucified. identified with Christ. I was by miracle baptized, buried with him by baptism into his death. I was by miracle raised up together with him. Hallelujah. Huh? I was by miracle received a new birth, a new heart, and a new spirit. That's how big the miracle is. Oh, well, I believe in the miracle of getting a new heart and a new spirit and becoming a new creation, but I don't believe it could be a miracle where I would actually be crucified with Christ. And if that makes sense to you, you need to think differently, because it's all a miracle. Hallelujah. I live a miracle life. I was raised up together with him. I'm alive together with him. And by miracle, I'm seated together with him in a heavenly realm at this very moment. And when you know that and when it becomes true to you, all of a sudden you're not trying to get some prayer through, not trying to flow in the Holy Ghost. Not trying to have some authority. You're sitting in the throne room, man. Hello. I know, I've been real stupid in the throne room too, believe me. In fact, I've probably been more stupid than anybody else in the throne room, because I've actually got to go there by vision, and you should have heard what I had to say. I had my opportunity to find out what was going to come to pass in the near future, and I'm so consumed with my own self-interest and condemnation, I'm asking what I did wrong. I mean, you know, come on, people, I understand this problem that we have. Father, I understand it so well. The Lord's been able to help me to get over myself, and so that I could also help you get over yourself. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo. I mean, I tell you right now, you'll get to the place you want to so get over yourself, it ain't no problem to deny it anymore. You're like, I'm dumb. I hate my life in this world. Compared to my life in God, I'm telling you, you're done. Oh, this is good. I mean, I got the life of God. I got the life of Jesus. I got the life of the Holy Spirit. I'm not living that life no more. A dear friend of mine, preacher friend of mine, great man of God. God's used him in amazing ways throughout the world. And he said to me, Pastor Mark, I just want you to know the guy you knew last year is dead. I said, no, he's not. He's looking at me. I said, he's not dead. He just grown up some. Hallelujah. You done died, praise God. How you are buried and you raised up together and you're not dying no more. You've been raised up together and you're dying no more in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Now you got yourself some denying to do. You got yourself some work to do. Hallelujah. Huh? You got some shutting your mouth when you want to speak to do. Huh? You got some calming down when you want to get angry to do. Huh? You got some loneliness that you're going to have to learn when you want to be a defender of yourself and of all your personal interests. I'd rather glorify the name of Jesus than try to preserve my own fame. I hope I don't have any. I hope my whole life is in him. I hope your whole life is in him. Hallelujah. And if it's not, just jump in right now. If it's not, if your whole life's not in him, I want you to be born again and come into the faith. But if you've been born again, you come into the faith, then your whole life is in him, whether you recognize it or not. Memo. Hello. You know, Peter said, as long as I'm in this tabernacle, I'm going to stir you up by putting you in remembrance of these things. And when I finally got that, I go, wow, this is so important to Peter. I'm going to take up the torch. So long as I'm in this tabernacle, I'm going to put you in remembrance of these things. If it's that important to Peter, I'm going to make it that important to me. And I hope you make it that important to you. So some people need to go read what he said. So you know it firsthand. So you can put people in remembrance of it. Hallelujah. And that really, I mean, the thing about what Peter says there, the radical things that he expresses there in the first chapter, in the second chapter of 2 Peter, those radical things that are declared there, this opportunity, this divine opportunity that we have, when he highlights that even more important and even more certain than the audible voice of Father speaking, go ahead, take another drink, the audible voice of Father speaking is not to even be compared to the Word of God. He says we have a more certain word of prophecy than the audible voice of God. Somebody said, hey, I went over to the meeting, they prophesied over me. I'm just like, big deal, man. Come on. I haven't hardly seen you do anything that God's already prophesied over you. So why are you so, you know, excited about some man prophesying over you? Peter said, we heard the audible voice. when we saw the excellency of his glory, when he said, "This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased, hear ye him." But you have a more certain word of prophecy that you do well if you take heed unto it as a light shining in a dark place. For the word of God, came not by men, but by holy prophets and apostles. The inspired God-breathed word, which is profitable for instruction, for doctrine. Come on. The power and the authority of the word, where you come under the power and the authority of the word of God. Amen. Guys, quit playing around with the speakers. Come on, get in the program. Got people drinking water, coffee, Kool-Aid. Somebody over here, you know, they got a juicer or whatever. I'm surprised somebody hadn't laid out a banquet. We just go so long. Help us, Lord. You want to go ahead and take care of that? Just go ahead and shut it down. It isn't that hard. It's one volume, one speaker. Go pull a plug, something. Here we go. Look, just look at, I just come and look at a couple of verses of scripture with me here. Hallelujah. You know what? You know what you're supposed to do in your most biggest crisis? And the biggest challenge is, you know what you're supposed to do? You're supposed to start dance around saying, God is so good, hallelujah. God is so good, hallelujah. Oh God, he is so good. Oh, he's so good to me. Everything changes. Instead of meditating on the wrong thing, sitting there believing a lie. You believe a lie, you'll be.
Yeah.
You believe the truth, you shall. If you could just get that, if we could just get everybody to get that, what a breakthrough, huh? Quit while you're ahead. You know, that's one of those sayings. Hallelujah. We love all you guys. Praise God. Just get into the Word. I mean, I don't want you to go home thinking, man, we spent the whole meeting trying to rewire the thing. Look in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. Hallelujah. Kate robia sona. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. People think they're going to learn how to walk and function in miracles without having to get in the big mess of the problem. You want to grow in God, you got to get yourself in trouble. You got to get yourself way out there on the water. Come on, people. It's just time to engage, and don't weary in well-doing, because you will reap if you do not faint. That's not talking about your finances. You just reduce everything in God to some financial thing. Listen, he took his riches. He took all of his riches. He who is rich took all of his wealth and laid it aside and became poor for our sake. It's like he took all of his wealth and put it in a safety deposit box and became poor for our sake, that through his poverty, he could open his safety deposit box and give it all to us. And the spiritual riches, it's his urabateya. It's his relationship with the Father. It's his ability to see the Father before him and at his right hand so that he should not be moved. It's a place that he came to where he's denied himself and he wouldn't do anything of himself. He only did what he heard the Father say. To resign yourself over to saying, Father, I'm going to live to do your will. Is it just keep creeping up on you? Should I use another mic? Is it a mic issue? Just coach me. Oh, Matthew chapter 7 and verse 21. See, the Lord says, not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but those who do the will of the Father, which is in heaven. This is really and fundamentally, as we look at this, this is actually, if there is a secret, this is the secret to Christ Jesus' authority. He said, I do nothing of myself. It's the Father that does the work. Amen. I'm not here to glorify myself or to witness on my own behalf or to make myself something. It's the Father who witnesses on my behalf. He's the one who's made me something. I live only to do what he's purposed me to do. I want you to look at this other verse of scripture here in Matthew 12, chapter 12, verse 50. Jesus goes on to describe in the importance of the will of the Father, because he says this is the identification of those who are a part of the family of God. He says, for whosoever will do the will of the Father, which is in heaven, the same is my family, is my brother, is my sister, and is my mother. Because they brought to him his family and they said, your family's outside. He said, no. My family is the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. I want you to grab a hold of some things here tonight and recognize that you can't just do your own plan, try to make something up. I mean, you know that, fine. You know, you can brag about that you can write a word when you're in first grade. But when you now in college, don't tell me, come bragging to me that you wrote a word. Huh? Don't come brag and say I laid hands on somebody that got sick. I mean, or I laid somebody, I laid my hands on somebody that got healed. Whoopee-doo. You should be taking nations by now. You laid your hands on somebody that got healed. You did that the first day. You can do that the first day you were born from above. Oh, I witnessed to somebody. Whoa. You witnessed to somebody. You didn't impress me. When you said that, oh, I witnessed to somebody today. Oh, like you haven't been. Surprise. This is now a big deal to you. I mean, if this is ongoing, you're not going to be telling me that stuff. Are you listening over here? Come on, people. We're not keepers of the aquarium. We're not babysitting the nursery. Come on, people. We're raising people, a mighty army up, disciplined in the Holy Ghost to go do what God said to do. In the name of Jesus. The Lord said to the Pharisees, he said, listen, you said you would go and you did not go. They said they would not go and they're going. And I tell you that harlots and thieves will come into the kingdom before you do. I don't want to be in that class of those saying, I'm going, praise God, I'm going. And that's what I do for the rest of my life. I'm going. Oh, praise God. I'm going. I never do anything but sing about it, talk about it. And it's all a form. And I never do it. Come on now. Once again, that was in the context when Jesus said it was in the context of doing the will of the Father. The will of the Father is very important. John 5:30, Jesus said, I can of my own self do nothing. That boggles my mind. It boggles my thinking. It causes me to recognize such a dependency that Jesus Christ has called us in to depend upon him. I mean, and I don't even have, I can't, it's hard for me even to draw out the comparison because he's God manifested in the flesh. He's God manifested in the flesh. Baptized in the Holy Ghost without measure. And he's saying, I can do nothing of myself. People, that redefines Pentecost. That redefines Pentecost. Because here you and I, praise God, we have been born again by the Spirit of the Lord. And to God, that is something that is so holy, that is so sacred, that is so acceptable. There is no sin. There is no remembrance of it. It has been removed as far as the east from the west. I mean, God has made us everything by his grace that he's been looking for. He's empowered us with all acceptableness so that we are not other. He's not otherness, that we come into oneness with him. And yet, and he's baptized us in the Holy Spirit. And somehow we've got to begin to understand this dynamic of relationship that he's waiting to have with us, where we come to a place that we stop doing anything of ourselves and we start moving with his word and we start moving in his direction, because his eyes go to and fro. He searches for people who's going to really get real with him and start doing it instead of pretend, instead of out of religion. I try to say that because I want to make it sound like a drug. Or religianity, because I want to try to make that sound like Christianity when it's not. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Because we do that. We got our own forms. We got our own rituals. We have so convinced ourselves in our mind that we are right and we are so wrong. And it's provable. All you got to do is read the Word of God. All you got to do is start reading the Word of God and say, okay, Lord, I know I'm bound to do it. I'm going to go do it. Lord, by your strength, by your power, I'm going to go do it. I'm going to stop saying, I'm going. Oh, praise God, I'm going. I'm going to do it. Oh, praise God, I'm going to do it. You ain't done nothing. You want to gain the skill to strike lightning to the hearts of people? you're going to have to start spending a whole lot of time ministering to a whole lot of people. First and foremost, down on your face, crying out to God, oh Lord, anoint me with the Holy Ghost, because there's no way I can be a witness unto you and unto your resurrection without being endued with power. And you get real and you get passionate about it and you get needy, and then you start going. You start breaking through the barriers of fear. You start breaking through the barriers of humanism, secular humanism. You start breaking through the barriers of intimidation, self-consciousness, self-interest, etc. You got all those layers. And most people haven't even started busting through them yet. And yet God's giving you his all power and authority to bust through them. You start busting through them, God give you some skill.
Amen.
Skill is developed by activity. Huh? Faith grows and increases by the use of it. It's just like preaching. The more you preach, the better preacher you're going to become because of the use of it. Huh? I'm not just talking about somebody who knows how to give a story. I'm talking about preaching. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Speaking by the Spirit of the Lord. Huh? The more you speak by the Spirit of the Lord, the more you're giving word of knowledge. Usually when you give word of knowledge, you don't even hardly know you're doing it.
Amen.
You just see people all of a sudden start sobbing or have an expression of shock on their face. God wants to use you. Dear people, God wants to use you. You don't have any idea how he wants to use you.
Yeah.
It is on the measure and the level of his only begotten Son, because he's made you one with him. Your whole life is like a branch in the vine of interdependency. It just blows my mind, the interdependency that the Lord has placed within our lives. He's made a covenant. He's gone away and says, I'm giving all power and authority to my church. I've baptized my church with all that I have and all that I am. He loved to be hid away. Now he's really hid away and has sent forth his church to go and do the things that he himself is doing right now in heaven. The church is the fullness of him that filleth all things. And there's too many people that are willing to sit by and let it be less than that. Leave your work to someone else to do. Actually, tonight I had an open vision of shovels. The Lord said, hand them out.
Amen.
Hallelujah. There's a vein for the silver.
Amen.
But you got to dig, buddy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's a place for gold, but you're going to have to dig. Hallelujah. There's a time you can just speak to the rock and the water comes out, but sometimes he says, take your staffs and dig and cry out, spring up, oh well. Hallelujah. Mangete bradasite. Just because you don't be lazy. You can't be lazy. Faith isn't lazy. Huh? Faith is not wimpy. Huh? You're going to have to get yourself some incredible strength and boldness. And God, the Holy Ghost, is going to supply it. He's going to supply strength. He's going to supply passion. He's going to supply determination. Those words are all encapsulated in faithfulness. It is the disposition of the Father that he's given us. And faithfulness is an outcome of faith. Hallelujah. Faithfulness is the activity of continually living in faith. I'm not going to stop. You're not going to beat me down. You're not going to stop me. Huh? I can prove that. 35 years, you're not going to stop me.
Amen.
And I guarantee you, I've been through more than any of you. I've dealt with more problems, more issues, more devils. And I'm telling you right now, I love to see people get promoted. But when I see people get promoted, you know what? I realize that they have also to be equipped. Because as soon as you get promoted, Satan's that much more interested in taking you down. Huh? That's why we learned long ago, we don't want to send people out on the streets to go witnessing until they got a prayer life. Huh? They don't have a prayer life, they're going to be taken out inside of weeks. It's taken out by the powers of darkness. They don't even, they begin to start being a little effective in the kingdom, and all of a sudden all hell breaks loose in their house. All hell breaks loose in their body. All hell breaks loose in their relationships. All hell breaks loose in their finances. And they don't even know how to stand up against the devil. They just take it and fall and collapse. Huh? And put up the little white flag. Call the pastor for counseling. It's time, people. Come on now. Oh, God wants us to be soldiers who know how to endure hardness. Hallelujah. Who do not entangle themselves with the affairs of this life, that they may please him who has called them. That they may please him who has called them to be what? Soldiers. People in an army, militant. Hello. I don't know what people thought they were going out for a picnic. They thought they were going to play. They're going to go play some recreational game, huh? We're all going to go take our water floaties and go float down the river, or whatever. Come on. We engage for the souls of men. Father gave us the ability to go forth and subdue. He said he will give me this is Jesus' ministry, this is Jesus' inheritance. He will give me the uttermost parts of the earth for my possession and the lost for my inheritance. That's my ministry then, because I'm in him and he's in me. I'm the branch and he's the vine. And then in that place, in that context of taking up that which he is passionate about, that which is his vision, that which is his purpose, I begin to produce fruit. What is the fruit? It's those things of his authority that he entrusted unto us in his church. Huh? What is that? Power over unclean spirits to cast them out. Authority and power over diseases. Because that's what he did. That's his ministry. That's his work. We know how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil. That's his ministry. That's his goods. That's the function of what he was doing. That's the function of his riches and of his household. That is the authority that he functioned in, that he now gave to you and me. Amen. As his servants. And he says, multiply it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Kutaraba satara hishia. Hakarada fateya. I've got some inclinations of what it's going to result in the life that is to come. Huh? I'm telling you right now, I'm not planning on living in Shantytown in the kingdom of God. Are you listening to me? I know that everything in heaven is going to be glorious and rich, but I'm going to tell you right now, there's going to be some things in contrast that looks like Shantytown. I'm going to tell you, I'm not going to live in Pauper's Hill, and is listening to me, in the Potter's Field, huh? In the kingdom. Come on, people. I'm not going to be in the nosebleed section when the King of Glory comes walking in. I want to be right up with the champions. What you doing? I'm running a race to win. And everybody who runs a race to win wins. Everybody who runs it to win. If you don't know what that means, I believe that most everybody in the place knows what that means. The discipline that it takes, the effort that it takes, the pain. The commitment that it takes to win a race. Father says you're not going to be crowned with masteries, huh? Unless you strive for them lawfully, huh? You're not going to learn how to jump the hurdles unless you work at it with the discipline and the craft and the skill set that is there available to you. You're not going to learn how to do miracles and signs and wonders unless you give yourself to being developed by the Holy Ghost and walking in a connectivity with the anointing that is functioning in the midst of the body of Christ. You don't want God growling at you.
No.
Tell you not now. And I tell you, he's angry with unbelief. He's angry with stubbornness. He's angry with lukewarmness and slothfulness, slow to move. You better get your tail end lit on fire. Are you listening to me? Because then you'll start moving. Right? The foxes? Right? Dear friend of mine says it doesn't matter what the fox looks like. The fox could have three legs and one eye, but you light his tail on fire and he's going to run just like all the rest of the foxes. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 Huh? Lord, Jesus. Somebody said, well, God's been disciplining me, but it hadn't done nothing. Uh-oh. That's the proof that you got rebellion that's got no cure. That would be the proof that you have rebellion that has no cure. You have a stubbornness that has no remedy. It's called an incurable wound. Go read about what Father said that concerning Israel in that condition. Don't run the risk. Get a smile on your face. Get happy. Get busy. Oh, it's just an extra load in the day. Don't you care? Somebody said, you need to respect the church, the people that come to the church. They got to get up and go to work in the morning. I said, no, their work in the morning needs to respect the church. We're not going to pander to their earthly concerns and all their other interests and their cares of life and their deceitfulness of riches, all their CRP, pleasures of this world that chokes the word, so it can't bring no fruit, can't bring forth fruit. Come on, people. I know you were in church this morning till 2 o'clock. I had no idea why people were leaving. I get in this time thing, you know. I just like don't even know what's going on. And I was like, what's going on? Why is the baby so fussy? I had no idea. It was 12:30. It was already the next day. Somebody said, I would ask you to minister, but I know you minister by the calendar. Well, I said, well, it's going to be good. Hallelujah. You'll have an encounter, I pray. I'm certain. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, we would ask him to minister, but he ministers by the calendar. John 5:30. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge. See, this is because I'm in this with Jesus. I'm a branch, he's a vine. I'm in this with Jesus. I'm in him, he's in me. Father gave him, he gave it to me. His ministry, he gave it to me. So I say, I can do nothing of my own self. As I hear, I judge. What am I hearing? I'm hearing the word of God. And my judgment is just, is righteous, because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which has sent me. And here, I mean, this is, of course, there's a certain application and context here, but nonetheless, it covers every dimension of everything that Jesus was doing, not just a particular situation. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 2, Peter says to us concerning us arming ourselves with the same mind of Christ. And in verse 2, he says, open up your Bible so I can read this from the beginning. Anybody there? Okay. Let me just read this from the beginning. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1, therefore Christ, having suffered on our behalf, I don't know what version that is. Is that Greens? That isn't too bad. I just want to make sure I didn't get too deep into it. Green gives a good translation of the Greek. Therefore, Christ, having suffered on our behalf for us in the flesh. This doesn't read very well. That's the worst. Green is a great translation. It just doesn't read very well. For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourself likewise with the same mind. For he that suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. Most people don't even believe that's even possible. So that has absolutely no relevance or no meaning, like a bunch of other verses of Scripture that says the same thing. But nonetheless, we'll move on from that. Because I'm finding out that for a lot of people, not a very few verses of Scripture have any meaning at all. I mean, it just help us. It's just twisted and has their own application, and it's perfectly tailored, designed for whatever disobedience you're in at the time. Hello. There's a couple of people like this and a bunch of people that don't like it. And the people that don't like it, you're the problem. The people who do like it, they already in it. Because they heard the joyful sound and they got happy.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Come on now.
Yes.
Come on now. I'm not to talk to you like some kind of, facilitator. I'm not here to stroke you, make you feel better about yourself. I'm here to command you to change and come follow him and deny yourself. Hallelujah. I'm here to make yourself look so ugly you don't want to have nothing to do with it ever again. I'm here to make Jesus so beautiful and glorious before you and show you the power of God that's been made available to you that you grab a hold and never live the same again.
Yes. Amen.
Hallelujah. So here he says this, that he should no longer live the rest of his time in the flesh to the desires of men, but to the will of God. Huh? So you have to just go ahead and say, listen, there is a realm of authority that Father has called us to walk into, but we've got to recognize that this realm of authority that he's called us to walk into means that we've got to leave everything behind, that we've got to take no thought or concern for our own stuff anymore. But now we're going to come, we're going to walk in a realm of faith, we're going to seek a kingdom whose builder and maker is God, and we begin to understand now that I can't live for my own desires anymore. I can't live for what I think makes sense or what I believe is my obligations or my responsibilities as they have been mandated to me by men. Because that's the way most of us live. We do not live by the mandate of heaven.
So stop that. Amen. Amen. So I said stop that right now. Amen.
To no longer live according to the desires of men, but to live according to the will of the Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, my job's my mission field. That's fine until you make a transition over to the mission field.
How long is this transition going to be?
How long is, there's somebody to stay around and support the church, Pastor. No, there isn't.
Where's that verse?
It doesn't even exist. Is it convenient for you?
It's convenient for you. Because change really causes, change is disruptive.
Change is a whole lot of work. Change is very uncomfortable. If I came to you right now and I said, in Jesus' name, I demand you to pack up your stuff right now and you are going to move to Bozeman, Montana. What's the first thing you're going to ask me? Come on, what's the first thing you're going to ask me? Be honest. Who's paying for it? Where am I going to work? Who's taking care of me? Because I've lived my life trusting in the arm of flesh. And you're not going to tell me I got to somehow put my trust in God and go cold turkey on my addiction? Come on, people. I'm working on you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm getting at you. I'm going to box you into a corner and make you repent. Hallelujah. And start doing it right. I'm going to get you over into a place where you start getting desperate to start living for Jesus Christ if it costs you your life. I'm going to get you over into a place that demands you to start crying out for the lost, that starts believing God for the nations and the uttermost parts of the earth instead of sitting around counting your how many eggs you got in your basket. Hello? How many cars you got in your garage? How many shoes you have in your closet? Please. How much money you gave last year, didn't get any credit? Or whatever. Are you listening to me? Come on, people. Come on. Hello. My wife's slapping her head off right now. I can hear her. Hallelujah. 1 John 2:17. The Lord says, and the world passes away, and the lust thereof. But he that does the will of God abides forever. So it goes, John just corollary what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7. He said, listen unto everybody that says, Lord, Lord's coming into the kingdom. It says to do the will of the Father. It says to cease doing their own, living for themselves. Why is this so important? It's so important because you're never going to move in the authority. You're never going to move in the power and the glory and the demonstration of the Spirit of the Lord until it's all about doing Father's will. Because it's not for your tricks. It's not just to prove something about you. Because you just, you need to prove something. Come on now. Hallelujah. The Lord said that he gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to perfect you. That's a big problem. Let me say it again. He gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers to perfect you. That's a big problem because you don't need anybody to perfect you. Right? Oh, come on now. If you want to be perfected, you'll never be offended at correction ever again.
Amen.
Huh? There's so many things God would like to say if he said it and you just wilt. Huh? Come on, you should be the kind of people that say, Lord, shine the floodlight of heaven upon my soul.
Yes.
Lord, I want to stop being stagnant. I want to stop being just I don't want to be on the slow growth program anymore. Huh? It's not even a snail's pace. It's a sloth pace. You had to have, what is it, high-speed photography? Is that right? You got to have high-speed photography to see a sloth go an inch. Huh? Sloth pace. Come on, people. God wants us to run in the Spirit. He wants us to walk in the Spirit.
Amen.
Live in the Spirit. This is the good life. To perfect you, build you up, send you out. Perfect you, build you up for the work of a ministry, to send you out. The longest person I know in Scripture who stayed in the meeting before getting sent out was like Paul. He stayed 17 years. He kind of like, he's a good example. He stayed 17 years. But I mean, my goodness, the discipline that was going on in his life, the ministry that was going on in his life, he had already received an abundance of revelation. That had already happened. That had happened 14 years prior. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. When we look in 1 Corinthians, I'm going to just try to wrap this up real quickly. When we look at, because I want you to grab a hold of something in God. I'm just concerned that, just to make sure, that you are zealous and passionate for spiritual gifts, that you covet for spiritual gifts. In other words, you covet spiritual gifts, and you covet, in other words, this divine power and authority that has been given you. We need to have Pentecost, because we've been endued. Pentecost induces with power from on high, but I see a lot of people, supposedly they had a Pentecost and supposedly they've been endued with power from on high, but it's not getting the same results as we see in Acts chapter 2. And I don't want partial results. I think that that's wrong. If it doesn't match up, then something's wrong. You need to start over. It didn't match up. It didn't match up. I mean, Peter had all of his doubts and fears and his problem. That was pre-Pentecost. I didn't see any of them afterwards. He had his reluctance, huh? And he had his little bit of back and forth from home to following Jesus. But after Pentecost, I didn't see that anymore. I pray that you begin to cry out to God that you have Pentecost. I pray that you begin to cry out to God and begin to lay hold of Him individually, where you're at individually. These things are given to you. We speak them in a general way, and we deliver the Word of God to you, because it's supposed to produce in your heart not a breach, but a passion, where you get home and you hit your knees and you start crying out from God, and you say, I understand now, Father, that if I'm going to have a relationship with you, and it's going to be developed upon beyond, you know, just what is common and ordinary in the church, then I'm going to have to give myself over here to this realm of seeking you and knowing you right here on my knees. And I'm telling you, you're going to find something good. I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to find the silver, you're going to find the vein, you're going to hit. It is going to be the father load. You're going to hit who? I mean, it's going to be one explosive well of glory in your soul. I promise you. You have no idea what you've been neglecting. You have no idea what you have not been pursuing. It's all the riches beyond anything that's ever been told. And Father's looking for some people who come, begin to pursue Him passionately, to begin to be desperate for the life and ministry of Jesus to be revealed in our lives, is really what 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 through 11 is about. And we see there in verse 11 that the Holy Ghost divides individually to every man according to His will. And those are the things that the Lord Christ Jesus, the Son of Man, who went on a far journey, gave authority unto His servants. These are the things that we read about in Romans chapter 12. In Romans chapter 12, we understand the posture that's got to be in for us to recognize the grace that is given, the posture that's got to be in. I beseech you, I plead with you, I beg you, by the mercies of God, that you present yourself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And you know that that is first and foremost not dealing with something that you have to do, but dealing with the state of your consciousness, dealing with the state of your faith, dealing with the state of what you believe you are now in God and in Christ Jesus. Because for you to present yourself holy and acceptable, you got to believe the full work of divine grace that made you a new creature, that made you the dwelling place of Almighty God, that made you in every way holy and acceptable. It deals with the state of your faith. I plead with you, I beg you, get yourself in the faith, is another way of saying, get yourself in a place where you're everything that God's been looking for, you everything that's holy to Him, you everything that's acceptable to Him, you've been given the gift of righteousness, you've been given the gift of holiness, you find yourself one with Him, you find yourself as a branch in the vine, you find yourself empowered by Him, you find yourself endued by Him, you find yourself as a person that He lives in and walks in, hallelujah, He's your God and you're His people. That's just the posture. And what is it then, verse 2, so that you may prove what is the good and perfect will of the Father. You see that?
Yes.
Now he sets up, he begins to talk about the measure of grace, the measure of faith that is given to each man in proportion to the grace that he's received. Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. God's grace came to me, but it didn't come to me in vain. God had already proved what I was going to do. I'd labor more than everybody else. God gives you a little bit of grace, and He watches you sit around and watch TV with it. He watches you sit around and complain about people with it. He gives you something that's enough to get you moving, you're not activated. Come on now. Put yourself in Father's shoes for a few minutes. Put yourself in Father's side. And these are sacred things, and these are holy things, and these are the riches. I mean, think about it. The Lord gave us the greatest treasure, one, Christ Jesus, the Word who is hidden in His bosom. He gave Him as an offering for you and me. It's His lamb. He said, here, I'm going to give you my lamb so that you can have redemption. And then He says, listen, I've got a special, the most precious gift that I can give you. This is my most precious gift that I have to give you. And I cannot give this precious gift to you until my only begotten Son is slaughtered for you and goes down into hell for 3 days. Till my only begotten Son is despised and rejected and then slaughtered for you. But this is amazing. I'm going to give you my precious gift. And then people look at it and go, what's that? Because that's the Holy Ghost. It's the promise of the Father. It's His most special gift. It's His holy treasure. It's so sacred to Him. Jesus said, you can say whatever you want to say about me, blaspheme me, say whatever you want to say about me, or to our Father too. But if you speak against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven you, not in this world nor in the world to come. It shall never be, for you cannot be forgiven. Honey, listen to me. It's sacred. It's precious to Him. And people aren't earnest about these things. They're shy and they're shaming. I mean, God, the Holy Ghost, was persecuted in the back room. Now He has no room. Huh? Pentecost took place a little over 100 years ago, and it's almost been persecuted into extinction. Compared to what it was compared to what Pentecost was in 1906, it poured out April 9th, 1906, that paled in comparison to Pentecost that took place approximately in 30 AD. That paled in comparison. And that Pentecostal revival grew, and it grew up into the 40s, 30s and 40s. Huh? Now it's been persecuted. It's been on the downslope ever since. It's been on the downslope in many ways. We need Pentecost. Father's looking for some people going to do something with Pentecost. He sees me. I'm going to do something with Pentecost. You too. A couple of you. Some of you didn't hear what I said. You're busy with something else. Huh? Always getting distracted right at the wrong time. Huh? Are you listening to me? You have to lay hold on this thing. You have to fight for this. You have to fight for this. Let me tell you right now, you have to fight hell for this. You got heaven backing you up, but you have to fight hell for this. Yeah. Because Satan is the Antichrist spirit. The one thing that will defeat him is Christ Jesus. And the one thing that he was not going to abide and let it grow and mature, if it's any way as possible, is for any Christ to be born in you, or Christ Jesus to be revealed in you, any of His power and any of His authority. Because the power and the authority that is in Christ Jesus that is operated in our life by the Holy Ghost has absolute power over him. Absolute, absolute, absolute power over all hell. It's true. You think he's going to sit by and just let you have a run at it? No, you and I had to find ourselves completely hid in Christ Jesus with a passion, with a passion, with a determination that is absolutely unstoppable. And Papa gives us that. He gives us the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. That's a whole lot of passion and determination. And so the Lord says for us in Romans chapter 12, Paul's saying, you know, because he's really talking not about the threshold or a limitation. He's talking about a beginning. He's talking about a faithfulness in a beginning. And he says for us to be sober with what we've received. Huh? And if it's prophecy, then you get to prophesy according to the proportion of faith, because everything that you're going to do in God, central to it is faith, the gift of faith, the working of faith. Whether it's giving, you now have, because you have an anointing of faith to take a hold of finances, then you do it with sincerity. You don't do it manipulatively. And it lays it out. If you got all these various different dimensions of where your passion is. Some people's passion here in this church, I mean, I know it's been Leslie's passion, go to the hospital and pray for the sick, Mercy Ministries. Huh? People gather around that. You do it faithfully, according to the proportion of faith that's given you. Is that a threshold? No, it's a starting place. It's just like when we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 concerning the body and concerning the fact that the body has many different members. I mean, there are times that I'm in settings where I don't function, as it were, in a pastoral ministry. I function in a different type of a ministry. There are times I'm there in different places, different settings. I'm there just to serve. There's other times Father gives me a special grace to be able, you know, I go with Brother Yun, for example, and it's pronounced Un. I go with Brother Un, and I say Yun. I go with Brother Un, and he'll have me, he'll do the ministry, he'll have me just pray for all the sick. Okay, I go with Carlos and Nicarni, he does the same thing. He has me pray for the sick, people who need miracles. So I just function in that. There's times I just function in prophecy. But I can function in it all. And so can you if you just simply be faithful with the proportion of faith that has already been given you. What's going to happen? Faith is going to grow. You're just faithful with the grace that has been given you. Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. Everything. And he said, it's not me, but Christ in me. It's the grace that has been given me. He said, but I labor more than them all. It's not bestowed upon me in vain. I'm going after this with the passion. I'm wringing every drop of divine ability that's been given me. Come on, people. You're going to learn this on your knees in prayer. And if you don't have a passion that drives you to your knees, then there's something going on here that you need in your life. And Father wants to supply that to you. Because he's not limited you. All of these things must be understood in the realms of growing, maturing, and the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry. Recognize that if anyone believes, these works should they do also in greater works than these. But you've got to understand that there are spiritual laws that you're going to have to obey. Jesus obeyed spiritual laws. People can't go run ruin. They can't go and deny the rest of Romans chapter 12 and expect that things are going to work out in their life. They can't walk around and have love that has partiality in it, a love that is not sincere and pure. And the rest of the things that Paul names there in Romans chapter 12, that's really all about you and I being able to faithfully function in the proportion of grace, or in the grace that has been given us, in the proportion of faith by which we minister. This has to start with a zeal. Huh? Chrissy, I see a great zeal in your heart and in your life. I see a great zeal, a great passion. You can't wait. That's good. Huh? Hallelujah. The Lord wants to see that, and I want to be able to see that in every one of your lives. It's hard to see it when you're sitting there. Yeah. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Stand with me. Hallelujah. There's many more things to say here. We're just gonna end it here. Hallelujah. I want you to lift your hands towards heaven. And tonight, I want you to turn this thing around. Some of you, I think, have felt like that God's been imposing on you. Some of you feel like God's been imposing on you, just adding to the workload. Come on now, people. Come on, MP. We want you to turn that thing around. Say, that old job over there is imposing on me. Hallelujah. Turn this thing around. The great life is to live this life in the kingdom. Hallelujah. Right now, let the Spirit of the Lord overwhelm you. Let the glory of God come upon you. Right now, just go ahead and let the Spirit of the Lord come like a rushing mighty wind into your life. Let the Spirit of the Lord come like a rushing mighty wind. If some of you were baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues many years ago, and you didn't start doing what Pentecost was for, that's why you've not developed. That's why the tongues didn't excel in the interpretation of tongues. That's why the tongues did not excel into the miracles that it was supposed to excel into the other outworking of the ministry of Jesus Christ. Because listen, what is the Holy Ghost all about? What is the Holy Spirit all about? He's all about revealing Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus' ministry. It's all about Jesus' power and all about Jesus' authority to do the works of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Now, come on, guys. If you're going to get with it, get with it. Come on, because otherwise it's just it changes things. It messes it up. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Bosto Ramon Basse. Prosto Karaman Batase. Baraba Baba Batata Repeste. Baraba Baba Baba. Baraba Baba Sekate Bito Robo Shekate Torushiga. Ada Brananda Lamanda de Vesisti. In the name of Jesus. 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 Could you imagine that you received the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues by the grace of God, and it was poured out upon you in vain because you did not profit through it? Could you imagine that? Could you imagine that? Could you imagine that? Come on, sure you can. Come on now. Let's get some transparency before God here. Let's get some truth before God. Can you imagine receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues and you never had a passion to reach the lost? Because that's what it's all about. You should receive power from on high so that you could be my witnesses. Can you imagine that you were baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues so that you might excel and develop into the things and the expressions of prophecy and the expressions of interpretation of tongues? Because it's as an entrance gift that begins to develop us and begins to cause us to understand how to move into deeper realms of prayer. Having been baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, and you're not passionate about it to be continually filled with the Spirit, and you allow long stretches of your day to go doing whatever it is that pleases you, you're never going to walk in God's authority. You're going to be tossed to and fro. You're not going to live an overcomer's life. You're not going to understand the strength of the Lord and the power of His might, because He's a convenience. You change. You change. To be baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, and yet you're not willing to obey God and build up yourself in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping yourself in the love of God, understanding the product of the love of God, that the love of God now allows us to come into a place where we know the love of Christ, where we know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, and there are able to step in to the expressions of all the fullness of God, to be filled with all the fullness of God. The church will not express that which the church is until the individuals within the church are willing to be filled with the fullness of God. The church is the fullness of Him that filleth all things, but it's made up of living stones. Amen. Built up around the cornerstone. Amen. And everybody has the responsibility in the body of Christ. Yes. Everybody has the responsibility to take up their part of flowing in the anointing of the Holy Ghost, where the Spirit of the Lord baptizes us down into one body. And that's something that happens not because you stood in the prayer line, but because that prayer line resulted in you going and getting on your knees and spending time with God and touching heaven. Somebody said, oh, heaven touches me, I'm a little different. No, everybody's the same. Everybody's the same. Every single human being on the face of the earth has the same response to the Holy Ghost. Everyone. Tell me about who you are from your human genetics. Well, my daddy was, and my grandfather, or my great-grandmother was. You've been washed with the water of regeneration. You've been brought out of the family of humanity into the family of divinity. You've been brought out of the family. You've been brought out of the families of this earth into the family of God. That's just His grace has supplied it. Now go ahead, take the birthright, step into the inheritance. God fill you with hungry. God fill you with thirsty. Every tormenting, afflicting, harassing thing of Satan that has been a yoke around your neck, I break it. I break it in Jesus' name. That you will respond to the very passion of the Holy Ghost. That you will respond to the longings of the Holy Ghost. All David's got to do and Chris has got to do is be faithful to their music. Turn it up a little bit. All Jeremy has to do is be faithful to his music. Faithful to the ministry that they got going on. My wife was telling me about Daniel and his ministry this morning as he's ministering. She said, the anointing, the power of God that is upon his life is extraordinary. What will it look like in 10 years? All he's got to do is be faithful. 10 years, it will be extraordinary. I'm talking to you too. Where are you going to find a place to move in the Holy Ghost? Don't you tell me about how you helping me, because I really don't need any help. Hello? I got all the help I need. The Holy Ghost, I didn't read any scripture where God said he's going to send you to help me. Tell me, say, I have to send the Holy Ghost to help me. Give me a break. Get out of the way. 10 people will take your place. In other words, get out of the way. Go to the mission field. God raised up 10 people to take your place. I praise God for the abiding place. I praise God for your faithfulness. I praise God for your commitment to the church. The church is much bigger than these four walls. The church is about you stepping over into a realm of the anointing, because I'm telling you right now, the Church of the United States of America and the Western world needs fiery evangelists. It needs fiery men and women of God. Go run with the Word of God. Go run with the Spirit of God. Wake up His church. Tell people to receive the life of God, to receive the life of Jesus, to receive the life of the Spirit. To go with authority. You're here to receive. I don't want anybody running off having not received. All you're going to do is create problems. Give the Lord Jesus a bad name. Add to the poor reputation. You know what I'm saying? People, I'm telling you right now, I'm earnest. I'm passionate about being that much more empowered to bear witness unto who He is, to provide proof for who He is, that He is raised up from the dead. that he's now King of Kings and Lord of Lords, that he's empowered his church. Hallelujah. Karobo shikiti anamashaya. That we the proof providers of it. You know what? All you got to do is get yourself into the ministry out there on the street. And you'll find out how lack of anointing you got, how much lack of anointing you have. And then it's going to drive you to your knees. As long as you live in your little worlds that you create for yourself, you'll never have any challenges, and you'll make believe that you got something you don't have. Huh? You take whatever it is you got, and you go out there in the park, and you set up and you make yourself an altar call and see how many people respond to it. Are you listening to me? Hallelujah. It'll train you. You go home, flop down on the living room floor and say, Lord, I am just absolutely miserable. Lord, I don't have enough anointing to get anybody's attention. And I got to have it. Because you can either go one or two ways. You can get all discouraged and be all pathetic and give up. But if you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost, you got enough fire to recognize, wait a minute, I'm going to press in and lay hold on what God has given. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. It's about time that you start moving in the authority which God has given and stop speaking like a scribe and a Pharisee, someone without an anointing. Huh? Are you listening to me? Do you know how Andrew ministered before he was anointed? Huh? You know how Andrew ministered before he was anointed? We found the Messiah, come and see. You know how Philip ministered before he was anointed? We found the Messiah, come and see. He didn't have anything. And you know, Nathaniel said, could any good thing come out of Nazareth? He said, well, come take a look. They changed after Pentecost. Well, then they changed before Pentecost. When they were endued with power from on high, or rather, forgive me, when they were endued with the power that the Lord Jesus gave to them, power and authority, they commanded the devils, and they were subject to them through his name. Somebody was just looking, watching them one day, and wasn't even bona fide. You know what I'm saying? They weren't certified. They weren't even commissioned. They just watched them, and they had enough of a true heart, huh, that they went themselves and started casting out devils in the name of Jesus. Huh? And then John got all upset and said, you can't do that. You weren't over at the meeting. You can't do that. And because Jesus said, we saw him casting out devils in your name, and we forbid him. Jesus said, don't stop him. Don't forbid him. This is how easy it is to get in this. You can get in this just by watching somebody. Whoa! I'm going to tell you right now, God has just will break down every excuse you supposedly have. The reality of it is you're not doing it. You're not following the model. It takes arrogant men their lifetime to humble themselves to imitate God. And we don't want no arrogant men in here. People just believe a lot about themselves that is really just, you know, you can be certified by men, and you know, what is that value? What value is that? If you could just lay all that aside and it don't mean anything anymore, you're not so high on yourself anymore. So proud of yourself, because your mama been telling how proud she is of you all your life. And it develops to such a, you know, thing in your life. I said, Lord, I'm nothing without you. I can do nothing without you. Because you cannot do anything that matters or counts without him. He anoints me well. There was a time where one man got to be anointed prophet. There was a time where one man got to be anointed priest. There was one time when one man out of all the population of the earth was allowed to come near him. Now he says to anybody who will, come near, come on in. People, that's got to be special to us. I've ministered tonight by the Spirit of the Lord so that it would become special to you. So you begin to press in and lay hold on God, because this stuff isn't, it's free, but it's not cheap. Father's not throwing you the keys to the vehicle of the kingdom when your leg can't reach the gas pedal and your head can't see up over the dashboard, so to speak, because you're going to wreck. Are you listening to me? You're going to desire the sincere work, milk, the sincere nourishment of the Word of God if you're going to grow. You're going to learn how to rely upon the Holy Spirit if you're going to mature. And none of this will even happen, will not even happen, till you engage in what Jesus described, not what you described, not what men has described, not what religion has described, what Jesus described. Which don't say amen and not, don't say amen and you don't go and do it. Because you, when you say amen, you say, I vow myself to you, God. That's a dangerous thing if you don't mean it. I want everybody in here to say amen. But you can't be saying amen for the past 25 years and haven't done nothing. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Because you start doing this and it doesn't decrease in momentum. It increases in momentum.
Yes.
God doesn't send people out powerless. He sends us out with power. And when you go out and you begin to do the work of the Master, it grows and it matures. And you're not barren and unfruitful. You begin to bring in the sheaves. You go weeping, bearing precious seed as a sower who indiscriminately sows the seed. And you come rejoicing, bringing in the souls with you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is the way it works. Just like you were engaging this past week. You begin to fast and pray for people. There's just no escaping it. Father wants to develop you to where the lost and dying world is more important to you than all your stuff and all your comforts and all your needs and all your little whatevers. Because most people are all upset and bent out of shape over their little stuff. Mine. Me. The Lord said, deny that. You can't work, you can't operate or please God or do the will of the Father wrapped up in that. He said, let me give you heavenly vision. Let me show you what life's really about. Let me show you what the meaning of your life is. Let me show you. Let me cast a vision for you of what I want to do with you and through you. To break off the strongholds of darkness off of the lives of the people. Now let me show you how I'm going to develop you and train you. Let me bring you into this place, a secret place with me. Let me bring you into this place of praise. Let me bring you into this place of devotion. And as you just respond to him, compassion grows in your heart. See, I believe that if a person is not born again, that they will spend their entire eternity in a place called the lake of fire. And because I believe it, how can I possibly walk by somebody and not tell them? Impossible. 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 To announce to them, you've got to get right. Are you right with God? Or whatever the Lord lays on my heart. Because when I've been in prayer, and you're not supposed to go anywhere without it, touch heaven, fire God's on you, anointing God's on you. And every time you minister, every time you just move with him, go with him, just do whatever it is he's inspiring you to do, the anointing, his manifest presence just gets stronger all through the day. By the end of the day, you're drunk in the Holy Ghost. By the end of the day, it's an explosion of divine praise and rapture. Jesus. Jesus. I pray that I beg you, I plead with you. My wish, my desire is that you're so down upon your face before God, crying out, Father, that there be no sickness nor disease that can escape the authority in the place. You know, I've wondered why people haven't even fasted and prayed for their own children. That's a detachment. You got to be really detached. As far as I'm concerned, you have to be really detached from any reality in God. To not fast and pray for your own children that are lost. To not fast and pray of your family. Did you know that I would say that probably a huge majority of the church has never even done that? I'm sure that's not in this house. I'm sure there's enough reality in God that you can lay hold on God for your children. Hallelujah. And then that love just grows and extends beyond your children and be moved with the same love and compassion for the needs of other people's children. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for making the things of the kingdom real to us. The things that matter for eternity, make them real to us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And to you young people, those of you who aren't locked into mortgages and a slave to the system yet, don't do that. If your dad and your mom's telling you go get a mortgage, go buy a new car, do not listen to another word they got to say, because they're foolish. Amen. And they're leading you opposite to God. Start pouring your heart into where Father wants us, how Father wants to use you in the kingdom. You let job be a hobby for a little while if you want. And it really even shouldn't even go down that way. Because anybody in God's kingdom who's got any realm of faith and has got any kind of faith to produce finances should not be working for anyone else. They would have received an ability to create wealth, and business would serve ministry. Rather they wear themselves out at work, come to church, and fall asleep. Can you hear what I'm saying? I'm really trying to get you in attention here. I'm working you. I'm trying to paint you into a corner so you can't get out. In the name of Jesus. God needs laborers. Can you see Jesus in... As John relates it, he's moved with compassion because there's as sheep scattered with no shepherd. And he's ministering to them, healing them of their sicknesses and their diseases. And there's so many people to get to. And the need is so vast and the need is so great. He turns to his disciples and he says, pray. And ask that the Lord of the harvest would send forth laborers. For the harvest is plenteous, but the laborers are few. He doesn't just want any kind of laborers to go. He just doesn't want people religiously go teach people how to memorize scripture verses, never do anything with it. Because he's the model laborer. He's telling them to ask the Father to raise up laborers like him to do his work, to do what he's doing. He's the one who's bringing healing to the sheep. Those are the kind of shepherds that Father wants to raise up. I'm here busting yokes tonight. I'm by the Spirit of the living God, not going to allow you to get away with the stuff you've been getting away with. Pretending you're doing something.
Go cast out devils, raise the dead, tell the blind to see, the deaf to hear. Go reach the lost, go to nations, go lay down your life for 3 billion people that have never heard. Get to work. Then I guarantee we'll never hear another complaint out of you. You with me? There's only one thing that just absolutely sent Father over the edge. It wasn't adultery. It wasn't fornication. He dealt with that as it came up. What was it? What was it? Right. Hebrews 3 and 4. Good. Don't do that. He swore in his wrath. I want the Lord to swear as he did to me, as he did to Abraham. Yes. Saying, surely blessing I will bless you. I swear, I blessing I will bless you. I want him swearing to me like he did to Israel. And he received. Jesus. It's just a big deliverance meeting going on here. That's all that's going on. Geneva was asking me the other night about oppression and possession. I said, well, God's people born again call upon the name of Jesus. Certainly they're never ever possessed. But I look around and see people oppressed all the time. I've even seen people who know how to flow in the anointing of the Holy Ghost leave from flowing in the anointing of the Holy Ghost and step right in. Great men and women of God that I've been around and been able to be around, see them go step into an oppression. It's time to live. It's time to understand how to walk with God and live free. Start moving with Him in obedience to deal with the majority of it. Jesus. Quit being intimidated. Quit being fearful and afraid. Everyone who wants to be David, but there's usually only one in the midst of 7 billion. Huh? Whose zeal for God is so big that they would rather die than see his stand around and watch his name profaned. Stand around and watch his army be a coward. Come on now. Let's just have it. God's given us this. That's his spirit. God's given me his spirit. Thus, I'm going to have his behavior. I'm going to have his passion. I'm going to have his boldness. Tell me, come on, people. You need to redefine things for yourself. And recognize where your spirit's been ruling you and dictating to you what you're going to do. Rather than coming under the will of the Father, which is voluntary. Coming under the rulership of the Holy Ghost and letting him rule you. To where you have his boldness, his courageousness, his strength, his power, his passion, his heart for the lost. When you do, you'll have his divine ability. You'll have his divine authority. Jesus showed us. Father said it over and again. So many different ways. San Diego County needs a church set on fire of the Holy Ghost. If you speak with the tongues of men and angels and you don't know how to move in compassion and love, which is all about going to the cross. Because see, love is defined at the cross. Love isn't defined the way people want to make it, because I'm willing to hug you. Oh, bless you. Oh, praise God. Don't really like her, but. There's love there, you know. So you say, I want more love in your life. My life will participate with love. Let the love flow. And don't have love with have love with sincerity. King James said, without dissimulation. That particular Greek word is, I think, beautifully translated, genuine. Genuine love. But really, love is defined in the cross. If he loved us in such a way that he died for us, and he laid down his life for us. Then he says, how much more? He didn't say, we should do the same. He says, wait, how much more? If God Almighty would love you and me in such a way that he would die for us, then you and I, we should love so much more. We didn't lay all the riches of heaven aside, come take on the form of a servant. We've been filled with his love and Jesus. And the tongues of men, it profits you nothing, have not love. It's moving in this compassion. It's for souls. It's for the lost and dying world. It's to care for people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. To genuinely, purely care for them. Not to care for them so that they, you know, like you. To care for them in such a way that you deal with them in the truth. Hallelujah. Father's looking at you, searching your hearts. I'm talking, but he's searching your hearts. I'm telling you right now, I'm telling you, God is dealing with you face to face. He's dealing with you face to face. He demands truth in the inward parts. He demands it. And you can get all, some people get all ready to go do whatever it is. You know, it's like Israel. When God said move, they didn't want to move when he was in power. And he said, no, you missed it. Now they want to go. And now he says, you know, you wait, you get what you need. He says, come on, let's just do it Father's way. He wants to empower you tonight. But I can tell you right now, I can come to different ones of you and I can tell you, you do not speak by the Holy Ghost. You speak right out of a human realm. And if you go with that and start telling somebody about Jesus, it's nothing but a human presentation of the gospel. Huh? Give me a break. Why don't you let somebody get in your life and start showing you that after all these years, all it sounds like is you. No heaven is in it. Huh? I'm talking to some people in here. I'm not just talking to people on the web now. There are actually people in this place. You listen to me. There's people in this place. Right here tonight. That the demonic oppression that has been in your life hasn't even been able to be dealt with. Because if we were to start dealing with it, all you would do is take offense. That's it. Can't take correction. You just take offense. You just be beaten down by somebody don't like me again. They just don't beat me up. Okay. You're stuck. Because you've not gotten real with God yet. And you may have been in church all your life. And you may be 100 years old. But that don't count for nothing. What counts for things is your heart's changed. And you say, shine the floodlight upon my soul. Correct me, O God. I want to be instructed. I want to start responding to you. I want you to be able to deal with the demonic oppression that is in my life. Can you imagine that one of God's people being the protector of the demonic oppression in their life? It could even easily be dealt with, but no. You start dealing with it, and all they do is get worse. Come fall on the rock. You know what I'm saying? Come be broken. See, people need to come to the end of themselves and collapse before Jesus. Huh? Amen. I'm not talking about you. I wouldn't be looking at you if I was talking about you. I'm able to look at you and talk about these things because you're doing it. Because if I start looking at people too long that aren't doing this, I'm going to call you out. I'm just too transparent. I'll say you the person. You know what I'm saying? So I just don't stare at you. It's true. You could know I'm talking to you if I'm not looking at you. just real. It's just real. Because you can't speak truth to falsehood. It bounces back. It's conflictory. Let God search you out. Heaven and hell is an eternal place. And it isn't those who say, Lord, Lord Jesus, Lord, really, you are my Lord. You absolutely are my Lord. No, it's those who do the will of the Father. Some people want to define iniquity only in the realms of the things they hate, like homosexuality or other perversions. But I'm telling you right now, iniquity is also found in the realms of pride and arrogancy and strife and division and hatred and rebellion and stubbornness. People always say, they're scared of witchcraft, but stubbornness and rebellion is witchcraft too. Father wants to take you into a place, if you'll just do this. If you go into a place along with him, just collapse before him and say, Father, I've got to change. I want to change. I've been in all the prayer lines. I've had all the different people pray for me, but it's never resulted in me being broken. And I don't want to be broken. I've never touched heaven to the point where I sobbed before him over the lack of his glory, over the lack of his glory being manifested in my life. I've never collapsed and sobbed before him over the fact that I don't even have enough anointing to reach the lost. Never. It's never been that real to me, but I want it to be that real to me. And when you begin to talk to him like that, I'm going to tell you right now, I promise you, he will answer. When you begin to read the Bible, and as you read the Bible, you say, I got to have that. Lord, I want that. Every verse, yes, Lord, I want that. Please, Father, do this in my life. I cannot live without. I promise you. That's what he's dedicated. He is devoted to fulfilling all of his word and all of his good pleasure in our lives. Because people celebrating an anniversary of Azusa Street isn't going to bring revival. It's a broken and a contrite heart and people getting real with God that's going to bring revival. It isn't having a keynote speaker and the best bands around and everybody standing there feeling good. It's everybody getting broken. It's everybody getting real. It's everybody getting transparent with God. It's everybody saying, okay, from now on, Father, I'm living to do your will. Okay, I'm taking up the mantle. Okay, I'm taking up the cross. Okay, I'm taking up the torch. Okay, I'm not living for myself no more. I'm done with me. Nobody standing in this place here tonight knows how in the number of your days. It so hit me when one of my dearest friends for certain, because we've been friends since I was 14 years old. Great anointing, great man of God, building things in the kingdom that very few people have built. Building wealth, built a business that literally serves ministry rather than the other thing, way around. On right around 11 p.m. on January the 3rd, dies of a massive heart attack, was dead in minutes. No one ever predicted that. No one ever thought it. That which he labored for, that which he built, it's really not about the kingdom now. It's all the people that are around the family and whatnot, taking their parts. Saying it wasn't about the kingdom, it was about us. It wasn't. That's for them to give an account. I'm just saying, I've looked at people doing very significant things. Jack Cole, what was he, 38? Jack Cole, 38, dies of a massive heart attack. One of the great anointed men of God in the 40s. You don't know how long you're going to be here. You don't know when you're going to be called to stand before the Lord. You have a short, your life is but a handbreadth. People think that they're going to live forever. I mean, in this life. They act like that they're going to live forever in this life. You know, you live forever, but you're going to transition from this life into the next. If I could just minister by the Holy Ghost to you tonight and cause you to see yourself standing before the judgment seat of Christ. And from this day forward, every action is weighed before the judgment seat of Christ. Before you do it, you're not like a child, like a teenager who hasn't got the ability to think of consequences. Huh? But you look and you can stand right there and you can see your deeds and your behavior right there before the judgment seat of Christ. Before you make a decision to do it, yea or nay, you see Father, you see the judgment seat. That comes by prayer. That comes by walking this out with God. This comes by getting real. And the spirit of real is here. And the spirit of truth, he's the spirit of real. God is moving by his spirit right now. God is moving by his spirit right now. I said to Mike, he told me the other day, I was laying a bunch of things on him, giving a bunch of things to do. I know it was way over his head. And he said, I'm just so thankful. I'm just so blessed that I get to be here and I get to be a part. And I said, you know, I said to Mike, you know, you might die in Kashmir. They may kill you for Jesus' sake. And he's like, really? Kind of thing, you know? I'm ready. Come on now. I just want to see all God's people. I want to see all God's people do that. So you know what's up with Mike? Mike, you know what's up with you? I know you're watching. You have nothing to lose. Others have so much to lose. So much of your life that your whole world is developed around something that will pass away. He has nothing to lose. He has nothing in this life. He has no world created for him but in heaven. Huh? Come on, people. It's a transition that every one of us were supposed to go through. We were supposed to be crucified with Christ and buried with him by baptism into his death and raised up with a brand new life to live his life, to do his will, to forsake house and family, to forsake everything, to take up our cross and follow him. Can you put it all on? Are you willing to put it all on the altar tonight? Are you willing to, first of all, see what God has made you, holy and acceptable? And then are you willing to be that? And are you willing to have a life that says, okay, Lord, wherever you lead me, I'll go. Whatever you want me to do, I'll do. With total abandonment, we turn to you and we say, okay, your assignment, you want to be used by God? Okay, your assignment is, Mike said, when he came, he said, I heard about the Mission Training Center, and I thought, oh, I want to go so desperately. And he said, I looked around, he said, my goodness, there's so many people here. I'm sure they're all wanting to go as desperately as I do, so I'm probably the last guy in a very, very long line. I said, actually, you were first. Actually, you were one of few in the line. He said, my whole life began, as it were, just like I was just more excited than anything else when you said, would you go? I want you to come to a place where you're in line. You need to get in line. You need to get in line. I want you to get rid of your plans. Get rid of them. Submit them to the Spirit of the Lord. Present yourself as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Forsake everything. Jesus said, if you want to be my disciple, you must forsake everything. Somebody said, could you please explain that in 2016 terms? Forsake everything. Take care of your cross and come follow me. It's just an altar call. I'm calling you to the altar. I'm calling you to the altar that Christ Jesus has built, that you built, and that you're going to lay yourself out on. And that you're going to take everything that you have and that's precious to you, and you're going to put it on the altar, and you're going to light a match. And you're going to offer it to the Lord. And now it's transferred from this realm into the kingdom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I see the Spirit of the Lord touching some of you. I see the power of God touching some of you. I see some of you ready to go. You're ripping and roaring to get out of here. You're digging for your keys right now. But I see others of you that are just getting broken before God, and I'm just blessed about it. Hallelujah. Where you're not holding on to your own life no more. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. One man of God said, we just don't talk about these things because it's like throwing a wet blanket on the fire. We just keep talking about there's things that they get excited about. Everybody jumps around. We have a Holy Ghost meeting, do a few little circle dances, a couple shouts, jumps and hallelujahs and praise God. Huh? A few tongues, a couple of laughters. No, man, come on now. I'm going to pray for a few people that are sick here in just a minute. What's up, Kristen? I just wanted to, Chrissy's developing in God, and I just want to make sure she's flowing in the same area, so it's good. Good go.
So I had a dream last night, and I didn't really make very much of it. I was in an outdoor meeting. A couple of us were in an outdoor meeting, and it wasn't like a meeting here in this church, but it was another meeting with another, a broader group of people, and we were there, and we were participating in the meeting, and at one point, Pastor Mark turned to me and a couple of other people from the church and was like, come on, this is this meeting's last chance for Pentecost. And I didn't really think much about it. And, there wasn't really much more to the dream, but it's like every time Pastor Mark said Pentecost tonight, it was like the Holy Ghost was holding me like, Pentecost, and like tonight, and I just was like ringing in my spirit, and I was like, Father, what is going on? Like, what does that mean? Like, it's last chance for Pentecost. Like, your mercies are renewed every morning, you can always do it. There's always another chance, but there's not, and he was telling me that it's about turning points. And that there's just, our life is a series of turning points, and every time we come out of prayer and every time we get up off the floor, we have a turning point. There's a turning point. And yes, his mercies are new, and there's always a chance, for us to, his mercies are new every morning, but we come to those turning points, and at some point there is a turning point where there's no turning back.
That's true.
There's some point, where we can't always turn away. We can't always turn away from going deeper. We can't always turn away from hungering and thirsting after it. If we want Pentecost in the God way, Pentecost, then we have to turn to it, and there's going to be a time when it's going to be cut off. There's going to be a window, and there's a time when the window is shut.
It's true.
And I don't know if that's the end of your life or if it's just you turn away too many times and your heart is hardened, but it's about the turning point. We just have to be sensitive to that.
No, it really, because Father has a schedule, he has a timeline. But what if there's nobody? What if there is really, 40 years ago in the church, I might have to say 50 years ago, 60 years ago in the church, there were people giving themselves continue to prayer and crying out to God. Father had some resources to work with. But what if Father doesn't have people that are mobilized to be sensitive to his schedule? He says, okay, today, now it's time, let's do this. But he's got no one to do it with. And that's really a lot of what is being pointed out by the Spirit of the Lord through Chrissy. And if we just begin to cry out to God, if I'm not just going to pray, I'm going to do. My mother told me, my mother was watching me about 34, 35 years ago. She saw me passionately praying, crying out to God about these things. And she said, son, this is good. She says, prayer is the key to heaven. But faith unlocks the door. You get yourself moving. I sit here and pray about it the whole time. Thanks, Mom. You got to get out there and start moving. Start doing it. I'm so thankful I didn't wait 35 years to start doing it. Because you know what? If I did, I'd still have the same anointing I had then. And I'm telling you right now, I'm not interested in having the same manifestation of life and the power of Jesus Christ in my life that I have now, next month. I'm pressing in.
Yes.
I'm going to go home and cry out to God.
Yes.
I'm going to wake up in the morning pressing in.
Amen.
I'm going to be passionate. Come
yes.
on now.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm very secure in who I am in Him and what He's done for me through His wonderful goodness and grace and mercy. But there's so much more. The fullness of His life, the working of His mighty power, His heart, the will of the Father, the passion of Christ Jesus for a lost and dying world. Thank you, Jesus. Some of you think about getting married. Would you marry Jesus tonight? Some of you are thinking about getting a job, getting a career. Would you take a heavenly vision tonight?
I heard what the Spirit was saying, and Christy also, is that there's people that you've never really had Pentecost. You've never really come to that place of a real Pentecost where you were baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, and it changed you so deep down on the inside that you didn't go back to those things over and over again. You come and you touch God to a certain degree, and you say, I don't want it anymore, and then you go back to it, and you go back to it, and it's because you haven't had that real Pentecost. And to have that real Pentecost, you have to be broken, you have to be humble, and you have to say, it is enough, it is enough. And I am going to seek God. I'm going to search after Him. I'm going to get on my face and I'm going to cry out. And you can do it in this very moment. But I am going to touch heaven. I'm going to touch it now. And I'm going to get serious with God. I'm not staying like this. I'm not going back again and again and finding myself in the same rut. I'm touching heaven and I'm going to get Pentecost. And it's going to change me. And I will never be the same.
It's true. It's true. So true. So true. The moving of the Holy Ghost always takes us right into the streets. The passion of the first love never dies. It never dies. Still, I feel like sticking your head out the window, driving down the road, screaming everybody to give their life over to Jesus. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Just start living this and you'll live it, and you'll begin to do it. It'll begin to grow, mature in your life, and you'll enjoy it. It'll be so much fun. It'll be so much fun. It's so much fun telling everybody to go to heaven.
Amen.
It's so much fun telling people, setting people free, blessing them in Jesus' name. It's so much fun. The enemy intimidates and lies. But if you could have Pentecost tonight, hallelujah. It's a change. It's, you know, really, it truly is. It's more than just tongues. Because it seems like that, you know, I don't even know what's been going on with that. I've asked Father, I said, well, what's even happening? There's so many people that, I don't know. I'm really not even sure. But I know it's supposed to be the whole expression of the fire of God. And the outworking of the power of God through our life in the ministry of Jesus to go seeking and saving that which is lost. It is so ignited with my heart. So Pentecost is to ignite my heart with the heart of Father.
to so embolden me. Being continually filled with the Spirit is really defined in when Peter says, Lord, stretch forth your hand and grant that there should be signs and wonders by your holy child Jesus. And suddenly the place was shaken and they were filled. Hallelujah. I'm just pleading with the Lord right now. I'm pleading with you. I'm pleading with the Lord. I'm just right in this tension. I'm looking for those things to happen, you see, while Peter yet spake. I'm looking for these things to happen. I'm not talking to your head. I'm talking to your spirit. I'm looking for a breaking open of, I'm breaking open of the vessel. Looking for a breaking open of the vessel. I'm looking for a breaking open of the vessel. I took that shovel that I saw in open vision tonight, and I'm digging in you. The Holy Ghost wants to dig within you, as it were, to open up these wells, this wellspring, this flow of heaven. Can't just flow for a night and then get, or flow for 2-3 days and get stopped up. That keeps repeating, it's going to be problematic in your life. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Dwayne, bring Noah here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Is Mom back there? Come stand. Sit, let Noah stand on his feet. Noah, can you walk around? Good. Praise God for that. How are you feeling? Feeling good? You've been having a bit of trouble? A little bit of trouble? Chris, are we going to pray for you so you don't have no trouble?
Yeah.
Mom and Dad? He's so completely over to the things of the Spirit. Don't hold on to your life. Give it over to the Lord. You're dead. And your life is hid with God in Christ. So that when Christ Jesus appears, you might also appear with him in glory. There's no possibility. There would be no possibility for you have been able to earn such a position and status in God, such an opportunity in the kingdom of God. You can't take it for granted. Father, thank you for the wonderful work of grace that's happening in Dwayne and Emily's life. So it's getting easier for you to hate your life in this world?
It's not hard.
Your people, you know what the Spirit of the Lord wants to do for us? Is he wants us to be able to see how glorious the realms of the kingdom is. That if we had the stack of the wealth of the world, if we had all of the opportunity, all the riches, it would still be something that we would hate in comparison to what we just got a glimpse of. Father wants you to be able to encounter His presence in such a way that it's, you're just desperate for more. You got to have more. You're not willing to trade it in for nothing. Were you walking around like me saying, Father, what do I have to do for this to increase? Father, what do I have to do to have that miracle anointing all the time, that kind of compassion all the time, that kind of explosion of divine grace all the time? I'm God. But if I've never had it one time, I don't even know what is, I don't even know what I'm missing. You know what I'm saying? I don't even know what to pray for. Why don't you reach your hands towards heaven? Start asking God to know what to pray for. Why don't you just get desperate with God, because you've got words that you can say. There's words you can say. You can say, Father, I want this that you have for me. I want these things that you died, Jesus, for me to have. I want to understand that I reckon myself to be dead unto sin, because I have been graced by your death at Calvary's cross, by bearing where you bore my sins in your own body, so that I could be dead to sin and live into righteousness. This realm is so real, it's so easy. It's right next to you. It's almost like a hand. It's almost just like you can reach out your arm and you can go right into that realm. It's just that close to you. You have to step out of your you and over into Him. You see, here's what people go to doing when I start talking like this. They go to begging God to do something for them, and it's just the wrong approach. He's asking you to let go of the stuff you're hanging on to. Because your arms are so filled with your stuff, you can't receive what He wants to give you. Believe me, I know, I've experienced it firsthand. The Lord started speaking to me in the 90s, saying, early 90s. I was just talking to Him, praying, saying, Lord, I just want to increase the anointing. Lord, I want more of you, Father. What am I going to do to step into this realm like you described in your word? And the Lord kept saying, get out of the way. And I didn't understand any of that. Just kept telling me, get out of the way. Suddenly I began to realize how tightly I was hanging on in my own life. Jesus. Just let the Lord Jesus touch you tonight. Is there anyone who wants to touch you? He will touch you in whatever way you'll let Him. He'll touch you. And in His long suffering and His gentleness and His mercy, He'll deal with you and He'll plead with you until all of a sudden you want Him more than anything else. You just want Him more than anything else. Where you begin to love Him more than all of these. Begin to love Him more than all these things. Hallelujah. Just let Him touch you right now, right where you're standing. Don't let your heart be overwhelmed. Just let Him touch you. Just let Him touch you. Let Him touch you. Let Him touch you with His love. Let Him touch you with His mercy. Let Him touch you with His joy. Hallelujah. You know what, the Lord Jesus, look at me over here. The Lord Jesus is going to heal you tonight. Okay? Tell me what's been going on. Can you tell me? Been sleepwalking?
Come over here. Give me a hug. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I speak peace into Noah's life, into the house. I bind and break the power of every afflicting, tormenting thing in Jesus' name. It has to obey me. Father, we thank you for authority over all unclean spirits, authority over all the works of the devil, authority over all sickness and over all disease and over all torment and over all affliction, over all harassment of any kind. Hallelujah. 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 I like looking over there and seeing Elizabeth because, you know that? It's just all surrendered. It's all surrendered to Him. It's all to Him. It's all His. Just living for the Master. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the name. Hallelujah. 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 Josh, the Lord's got some new assignments for you, man. Huh? Promotion in the kingdom of God. The Lord's been talking to me about Josh Matos. Promotion in the kingdom of God. Promotion in abilities and giftings and in things that you're going to be assigned to do in the ministry. Hallelujah. You're looking like you're excited about it. Hallelujah. It's because you've been doing it. It's not because you sit around over there, you play the drum so well. It's because you've been out there doing it. God sees you out there doing it. When He sees you caring for what He cares for and doing what He does, a man of God, old man of God, told me one time, says, you start reaching the lost and you certainly have God's attention. When you start reaching the people who've never heard or seen before, you've got Father's participation. This is where His whole heart is. This is where His whole heart is. Did you know that? Did you know that signs and wonders are just calling cards into the kingdom? It's an opportunity to get somebody on their knees, surrendering their life to Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Katoriba shikitara. Hallelujah. Well, you know, we just purchased the building. And you know, we got to purchase the building just with a down payment and deposit, so they got it all designed for us. And then we're going to get the thing delivered. Our timetable is to have it delivered the third week of July and to get it up. And so I know that many of you have made pledges towards that. So I understand that as soon as you get those pledges in, that's good. We got the building itself for right around $36,000, and then it takes about $36,000 to put it up. So it's basically right around $72,000 when it's done. Hallelujah. And so if you haven't pledged or you haven't really been moving in faith for that, you don't understand how to be a part of that, let God touch you. Let God, the Holy Ghost, touch you with a vision for what we're doing there and what's taking place there on those grounds. Because we believe with all of our heart that Father is going to raise up through us more missionaries
into the unreached people groups over the next 200 years than is at any other time. Because the harvest is plenteous. And Father's given us a plan. He's given us a heavenly vision. I'll tell you right now, if you've ever worked with me, you know that I don't sit around and tell you to go to work. Huh? I go to work too. And so I don't expect people to sit around and watch me work either. Huh? Telling me they're just there for moral support. They're just there to encourage me. Praying that I'd have the strength of 10 oxen. Well, they drink Kool-Aid in the shade. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Spirit of the Lord spoke to you tonight. He's prophesied to you tonight. He's warned you about a turning point. A timing that he has for you to step into the realms of Pentecost. He exhorted you, saying that if you step all the way over into the realm to where that Pentecost works within you, a complete surrender and brokenness as it's supposed to, you won't have this up and down life anymore. So you lay hold on that. Don't you just take it for granted. Don't take the things of God for granted. You lay hold on those things until the reality of it, heaven busts free in your soul. Don't, if you just go home and you say a little prayer, oh Lord, I would like to have that happen someday. That's just, you, I'm telling you right now, that isn't the passion that's required. If you just begin to take serious what Father said, you begin to cry out. And you pray and you intercede and you go to bed praying, you go to bed interceding, you wake up praying and intercede, and you find a place to get yourself alone with God, and you there every time, you there at that hour that you set, and you're crying out to Him, and you putting forth your desire and your petition towards heaven, you calling unto God, and you telling the Lord Jesus that He's your wellspring, He's your fountain, He's your Redeemer, your ransom price. He's your Lord and He's your Christ. And you've heard Him say, call unto Him and He will answer. It won't be long and you'll discover the breaking force of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Harabokustikita la 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 mashipra to sikitia tela la basipaya. Debrebe bete sikite pretusist. Tikaro sutire mamasitika la la mahate. Pierre mamatere de besikito la la mashipre bekita la la masapara la mashika. Mindanda la la besikata la. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for the great breaking force of your Spirit, of your anointing and of your glory like water, like rivers, oh God. Hallelujah. 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 In the name of Jesus. 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 Everybody just come on up here. Just come join us up here. Just come on up here. Just come, just lift your hands towards heaven. Lift your heart towards heaven.